Those topical questions. We'll now move on to the next item of business, which is a debate on motion 4570 in the name of Joan McAlpine on behalf of the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Relations Committee on reports on the implications of the European Union referendum in Scotland. I would invite members who wish to speak in this debate to press their request to speak buttons now. And I call on Joan McAlpine to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Relations Committee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It is fitting and timely that this debate should be taking place so shortly before the UK Government triggers Article 50 and starts upon the path of leaving the EU. The Committee's inquiry work since the EU referendum on the 23rd of June last year has revealed layer upon layer of complexity relating to leaving the European Union. The Committee initiated its work almost immediately after the referendum, and I must commend and thank my fellow committee members for the time and energy that they have committed to this inquiry. It has involved weekly, sometimes bi-weekly meetings, as well as visits, events and meetings with stakeholders and visiting parliamentarians. I think the fact that we are debating four reports today is testament to the hard work of the committee. Also, while we have held different positions on some issues, we have succeeded in reaching broad conclusions in a number of areas. From early in our inquiry, our two expert advisers, Professor Shona Douglas-Scott of Queen Mary School of Law and Professor Michael Keating of the University of Aberdeen in the Centre of Constitutional Change, have supported the committee's work, and I would like to thank them for the many written and oral briefings that they have provided to the committee and for their expertise and knowledge which has benefited our work. I would also like to thank our clerks with the committee who have worked incredibly hard over the course of this inquiry. An early action of the committee was to commission two pieces of research, the first into the long-term economic implications of Brexit from the Fraser of Allender Institute, and the second on the implications of leaving the EU for the devolution settlement from Professor Alan Page at the University of Dundee. Both of these pieces of research have been important in informing the committee's inquiry work, particularly our most recent report on determining Scotland's future, and I thank both the Fraser of Allender Institute and Professor Page for their work. I'd also like to thank SPICE for the many briefings that they have published on the impact of Brexit on individual sectors within Scotland, as well as the specific briefings that they have prepared for the committee. In conducting our inquiry, we aim to hear from stakeholders representing as many sectors as possible, as well as individuals affected by Brexit. I'm very grateful to all those who gave evidence to the committee. Their evidence deepened our understanding and raised our awareness on the implications for Scotland of leaving the EU. We received over 160 written submissions in response to our call for evidence, and the views contained in those submissions are summarised in one of the reports that we are debating today, Brexit, What Scotland Thinks. This report shows that for virtually all sectors of the economy, with the notable exception of the catching part of the fishing industry, Brexit is a challenge. Whether the submissions were focused on justice and home affairs, further and higher education, schools and skills, agriculture and food, climate change and the environment, health and sport, or equal opportunities and human rights, the overwhelming message was one of concern and the risks that they identified as lying ahead. There were fears about the risks of leaving the single market, about losing access to EU funding, such as Horizon 2020, about the erosion of rights, about the huge volume of legislation that would need to be revised, about environmental standards, and about losing the EU citizens that work in so many sectors. There was very little optimism or sense of opportunity in the evidence we received. The Brexit What Scotland Thinks report is a comprehensive summary of Scottish interests, and in the weeks, months and years ahead, I call on the Scottish Government and the UK Government to recognise those views in all discussions, negotiations and decisions relating to Scotland's future. The report should be a reference point for identifying both what is and what isn't in Scotland's interests. The committee also undertook an early visit to Brussels in July last year, as well as another in January this year. In July, there was still a sense of shock and disbelief concerning the result of the referendum and uncertainty about the next steps. However, by January, the Prime Minister had made her intention to pursue a hard Brexit known, and the experts in EU policy and the MEPs that we met were clear about the challenges of the negotiations that lay ahead for both parties. These two visits were very important for giving us a perspective on the views from Brussels on the negotiations. The visit to Brussels last July contributed to our first report in September, which summarised the initial evidence that we heard and our conclusion that access to the single market was of vital importance to Scotland. The visit in January was invaluable to extending our understanding of the withdrawal negotiations, negotiations to agree a new treaty, and the need for transitional arrangements. In January, we published a report, EU Migration and EU Citizens' Rights. The evidence that this report brings together on EU migration to Scotland provides valuable quantitative and qualitative material on migration patterns and the contribution of EU migrants to the Scottish economy and society. It also considers the rights of the 181,000 EU citizens resident in Scotland, who represent 3.4% of the population, as well as the rights that UK citizens enjoy as EU citizens, whether they live abroad or in Scotland. The UK's withdrawal from the EU has made all of our futures uncertain, but for no group is this uncertainty more keenly felt than those 181,000 EU citizens who live in Scotland and the Scots who have made their homes in Europe. In Scotland, EU citizens have settled in our cities, towns and rural communities. They have helped reverse the population decline that so worried us at the beginning of this century. They have contributed to the growth of our economy by filling skilled and unskilled temporary and permanent jobs. But most importantly, they have settled in our communities, enriched our lives and broadened our cultural horizons. In the report, we included testimonies from two EU citizens who have lived in Scotland for many years. Both have made their homes here and regarded Scotland as their home. But they were unclear about whether they could remain in future, particularly given the complexity of the 85-page form and the documentation on health insurance, national insurance contributions, employment and periods spent outside the UK that is required to apply for a residence card. It should not be forgotten that UK citizens living in this country and in Europe will also see a reduction in their rights on leaving the EU. We have become used to moving freely within the EU for business and pleasure, but in future, as a third country, we face the prospect of visa requirements or travel restrictions. We heard from the Scottish Youth Parliament that young people in Scotland see freedom of movement as an opportunity rather than a threat, and they want it to be protected. There must be consideration of how the rights of EU citizens in Scotland can be protected and how EU nationals already in Scotland can remain. Therefore, the committee concluded that in the future, there should be a bespoke or differentiated solution for immigration policy in Scotland. This would not only allow the Scottish Government to end any uncertainty for EU nationals, but also protect Scotland from the demographic risks associated with the reduction in the number of EU migrants. The committee's final report, published at the beginning of March, is entitled Determining Scotland's Future. It covers three key areas: future trading arrangements, intergovernmental relations, and the impact of withdrawal on the devolution settlement. The UK government has chosen to withdraw not only from the European Union, but also from the European Economic Area. Witnesses told us that the UK will leave the most successful free trade area in the world, and that it will no longer be a party to the EU's preferential trade agreements with over 50 other countries. Never, as we were told, has a country decided to dismantle its existing trade agreements in such a way. Scottish exporters have benefited from the abolition of tariffs and non-tariff barriers. It has become the norm to send Scottish produce across the continent without any border controls. There's no need to satisfy rules of origin for goods manufactured in Scotland and exported to the EU. All of this could go when we leave the EU. By choosing a hard Brexit and by entering the negotiations with red lines relating to freedom of movement, the jurisdiction of the European Court of Justice and EU legislation, the UK may find that it can only achieve a very limited trade agreement with the EU, and Scottish businesses will suffer as a result. Or, as we heard suggested at the weekend, the UK may be unable to reach a deal with the EU within 2 years and fall back on WTO rules. The UK will be reducing its trading opportunities by choice. We heard how, since the Second World War, there has been a progressive move to reduce tariffs and non-tariff barriers in international trade. The EU has made the greatest progress of any region in pursuing free trade. Like the UK government has decided that it wishes to give up these opportunities by leaving the EEA and to start from scratch in renegotiating its trading relationship with the world's biggest trading partner, as well as with other countries throughout the world. The possibility of a hard Brexit on WTO terms looks increasingly likely, as UK ministers have described this scenario as perfectly okay. In contrast, the Fraser of Allender Institute submitted a report to our committee that predicts this would result in a 5% reduction in GDP, a 7% reduction in real wages, and a loss of 80,000 jobs. Our latest report also considered the intergovernmental arrangements for agreeing the UK's position on Brexit, for conducting the negotiations with the EU on withdrawal, as well as the future trade relationship, and for intergovernmental relations between the UK government and the Scottish government. These will be the focus of other speakers, so I will limit myself to referring to the role that other sub-states have in relation to trade. During our inquiry work, we heard about the way that Quebec was included in the negotiations on CETA, along with the other Canadian provinces, and the influence that the Parliament of Wallonia was able to use to block the CETA agreement temporarily. Both of these examples highlight the comparative limitations of the intergovernmental structures in the UK. Finally, the committee's report considered the impact of withdrawal from the EU on the devolution settlement. As all members will be aware, under the devolution settlement, powers which are not reserved to Westminster are powers of the Scottish Parliament and of the Scottish Government. Thus, under the devolution settlement, current EU competencies, such as the environment, agriculture, fisheries and justice, and home affairs, fall within policy areas that are devolved. The committee concluded that, I quote, "We believe that any power currently a competence of the EU that is to be repatriated after Brexit and which is not currently listed in Schedule 5 of the Scotland Act 1998 should be fully devolved alongside a funding mechanism resulting in no detriment to Scotland." Scotland currently receives considerable funding under agricultural and structural funding programmes. There is no clarity about how funding in these areas would be calculated in future. The committee considered that there was a very significant risk to EU competitive funding streams, agricultural support and structural funding in Scotland following withdrawal from the EU. It was particularly concerned that, quotes, "any move towards a territorial funding framework within the UK that is based on population share rather than the allocation system currently in use would see Scotland's agricultural sector, for example, lose hundreds of millions of pounds," end quote. Finally, the majority of the committee concluded that a bespoke solution for Scotland to remain in the single market should be explored as part of the negotiations ahead, and that the UK government should provide a response to Scotland's place in Europe before Article 50 is triggered. In conclusion, you will see that there are significant implications for Scotland of the withdrawal from the EU and that the committee's reports highlight these. And I move the motion in my name. Thank you.
Thank you. I now call on Michael Russell to open for the government.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and let me also start by thanking the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Relations Committee for tabling the reports we are considering today and for its work, which has, and I'm sure will, contribute much to the wider consideration in our country of the implications of the EU referendum. There is, of course, a sense in which these implications cannot yet be fully understood and, of course, won't be for a long time. Nonetheless, the implications of the UK's rush towards and achievement of the hardest of Brexits will eventually emerge. The damage that will be done will not be completely visible on the day after the UK leaves the EU, but bit by bit its effect will be felt. Indeed, some of it is beginning to be felt already with increased prices and greater economic uncertainty. What our job is in this chamber is to find ways to mitigate such damage and, if possible, to avoid as much of it as we can. And it's the belief of the Scottish Government that that can now only be done by allowing the Scottish people to make an informed choice as to the future they prefer. This debate is very timely. It will give the Scottish Parliament a chance to reflect on key issues which are covered in the report and inform the wider public of the issues at stake. So at the outset, can I say that we broadly welcome the reports and their conclusions. if you give me a chance to make some progress, of course I will take Mr. Tomkins in a moment. So let me address some of the conclusions. The overarching findings from the reports highlight a number of common themes, including the economic, social, constitutional, and legal implications and challenges that we'll face when taken out of the European Union. The committee reports recognise a number of key benefits of European Union membership, the importance of the single market, the way that Scotland has benefited from increasing trade opportunities during the 43 years of membership, the fact that European Union membership and access has been of vital importance to Scotland's economy, the fact that migration is key to addressing Scotland's demographic challenges and the need to guarantee the rights of European Union citizens resident in the UK and recognise the importance of retaining freedom of movement, and recognise that the bespoke solution that reflects Scotland's majority vote to remain in the single market is required for Scotland. So in short, Presiding Officer, the committee comes to many of the same conclusions that we did in our own paper, Scotland's Place in Europe. And I particularly welcome the committee's recognition of the importance of membership of, not merely access to, the single market, and that a differentiated approach is required for Scotland. Of course, our paper, Scotland's Place in Europe, went further. It recommended continuing membership of the single market for the UK as a whole, pointing out the benefits of such membership. But that option was rejected by the Prime Minister 48 hours before the Scottish suggestions were discussed in the JMC. And that contempt for effective process, Presiding Officer, has been the pattern over the last few months. Even now, on this very day, we have no idea of the timing, substance, or format of the Article 50 letter. The JMC-EN agenda is meant to be set and shaped by officials from all the administrations, but there have been endless delays, papers have been provided late, discussion of key strategic choices left off the agenda and work plan, which we thought we had all said should appear. The JMC-EN terms of reference set the aim of agreeing a UK approach to and objectives for the Article 50 negotiations and oversight of those negotiations to ensure that, so far as possible in any negotiation, the outcomes agreed by all four administrations were achieved. Those terms of reference themselves were painstakingly negotiated and based on the Prime Minister's own commitment to agreeing a UK approach set out when she came to Scotland and met the First Minister on the 15th of July. Yet the Prime Minister now refers to the purpose of the committee as merely being for the devolved administrations to make representations to the UK government and behaves accordingly. The ministers from devolved administrations travel long distances to attend, as the meetings are always held in London. UK government ministers attend to listen to the devolved administrations, but rarely have insights of any substance to offer themselves. The JMC process has barely discussed a UK approach, let alone agreed a UK approach to Article 50 and the subsequent negotiations. Matters raised by me have been taken away for consideration, but not answered. It's clearly the UK government alone who are agreeing their approach, and there should be no pretense about that. But the Chamber does not have to take my word. As my Welsh colleague Mark Drakeford pointed out in his evidence to the House of Commons DECSU Committee, St Fagan's Community Council in my constituency, he said, would be better organised than most JMC meetings have been. And he added a sentiment I entirely agree with, namely, there is a need for greater effort to go into the basic running of this very important forum. And all this has bedeviled genuine attempts to get constructive progress, as has the growing insistence to the UK government that the campaign promise of repatriation of all relevant powers after Brexit was not a promise at all. Instead, a new concept of the UK's single market has been invented to give justification for what is an anti-devolution power grab, which is shamefully being supported by the Tory members of this Parliament against the interests of their constituents and our democracy. Yet, we've kept trying. Even now, we're prepared to continue to discuss areas of mutual concern and Brexit issues of vital importance to Scotland. But we must prepare ourselves for the future. We can have little, if any, confidence in the ability of the UK government to secure a deal that works for us. That deal, a compromise deal involving single market membership for Scotland and an increase in devolved powers, has been on offer from us for the past 3 months, but has produced no formal response. So the First Minister has rightly determined that we must provide a clear plan for the next 2 years. And she's done that by ensuring that the people of Scotland will get to choose between the Brexit deal as negotiated by the UK and independence on a prospectus that will be brought forward by the Scottish Government, of course.
Adam Tomkin.
Very grateful to the Minister for giving way to
picks up on the point that I wanted to intervene on earlier on in his remarks. He said, if I quote him correctly, right at the beginning of his remarks, that the implications of Brexit won't be understood for a long time. And he also said that on Monday, the First Minister called for an informed choice. Does it not therefore follow from his own logic that that informed choice cannot take place for a long time because the terms of Brexit won't be understood for a long time?
Minister.
It does not. And regrettably, not only Mr. Tomkins, but the entire Tory benches do not know what is in Article 50. Let me tell them what is in Article 50. There is a two-year timescale. And at the end of that two-year timescale, the European Parliament will vote yes or no. If the negotiated settlement with the EU from the UK can be voted on by the European Parliament, it can be voted on by the Scottish people. And we will put against that a clear option of independence. That will be an informed choice. And then the people of Scotland will choose. Now, let me carry on, Presiding Officer, because as the First Minister also made clear at her press conference on Monday, we remain open to a substantive and positive response to our paper and proposals. But it's hard to see it coming forward. And indeed, the opposite is still happening. Last Thursday, the Prime Minister's spokesperson ruled out any devolved responsibility for migration within hours of David Davis, with whom I have no issue in terms of his personal commitment to progress, indicating in the House that it might still be possible. And it was done whilst a high-level civil service negotiating group was still in existence, trying to identify a way forward. I do not know when next we will have contact on Brexit with UK ministers, as the JMC schedule for this week has been cancelled, though I should make it clear we want that contact to continue, and on many issues, such as the Great Repeal Bill, it will be essential. Leaving the EU will be profoundly damaging to our economy, our society, and our reputation in the world. The people of Scotland did not vote for that damage and have the right to reject it and to choose a different future. This government has a mandate for its manifesto for that approach. Each of us on this side of the chamber told our electorate that we believed that the Scottish Parliament should have the right to hold another referendum if there is a significant and material change in the circumstances that prevailed in 2014, such as Scotland being taken out of the EU against our will. That is quite a contrast. There is a contrast between that clear statement, which is now being honoured, which is underpinned by the fact that we are sitting here as an elected government, and that of the Tories in not so much a minority as the Tories, and that of the, indeed half the number, if I remember correctly, and that of the Tories in 2050, who will recall, whose manifesto said yes to the single market. So on mandates, let's be crystal clear. We are honouring a mandate, they're breaking one. And accordingly, we now have a plan in place which will move to the next stage on Tuesday and Wednesday when this Scottish Parliament will be asked to approve a request for a Section 30 order. Presiding Officer, those who believe in the 19th century concept of an untrammelled, sovereign, very British Parliament are now in charge of the Tory Party and in the UK Government. They're refusing to accept the help of those who contribute to our well-being because they come from elsewhere, who are reluctant to engage our young people from every background to live and learn in other places, who refuse to accept the judgment of courts outside our shores and look backwards with longing to the days of empire. For those people, the very idea of devolution is a threat to that sovereignty and to their myth-ridden, nostalgic worldview.
Please conclude.
They want power concentrated at Westminster. They believe it's the only place in which power should be exercised. I do not believe that. I believe in an independent future and a system that works for Scotland. So there is a choice to be made, and that choice will be the choice made by the Scottish people.
Thank you. I gave you slightly longer because you took quite a long intervention. I call Jackson Carlow, please, to open for Conservatives.
Presiding Officer, may I begin with my own tribute to the clerks and officials who serve the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Relations Committee. When this committee first established after the election and had a merry discussion about our work programme, it would be fair to say that neither MSPs nor officials anticipated the turn of events, which will no doubt be rehearsed throughout the debate this afternoon. In consequence, the committee has had extensive meetings, open consultations, taken evidence from ministers at Westminster and Holyrood, participated in visits to Brussels, and has engaged with diplomats from nations across the European Union, whether in it or not. Throughout, we tried, in a world where speculation, both informed and uninformed, was king, to establish the facts as best we could. And these four reports are a testament to the efforts of all the clerks and officials, and of my colleagues, and of our convener, Joan McAlpine. about whom I hope to pay a more extensive tribute in my own way later in my remarks. Ooh. On behalf of Rachel Hamilton and myself, may I thank them sincerely. Presiding Officer, nowhere in these reports will you find committee members arguing for a second referendum on Scottish independence. All of us campaigned for a Remain vote last June. None of us sought the challenge the majority voted for in the UK's referendum. And so beyond the politicking, the committee endeavoured to explore the potential for variations in any final UK settlement, which it might be open for Scotland to secure. Our visit to Brussels last summer suggested that on Erasmus, on Horizon 2020 and in other areas, such variations might be possible. But this advice was caveated. It was dependent, so we were told, by one member state's EU ambassador on the closest possible working relationship between Scottish government ministers and UK government ministers. The UK is the member state, and the other EU member states will take their lead from it. So we were told in this phrase, which Joan McAlpine and others have sought to diminish ever since, that should the relationship be in any way compromised, the shutters will come down all over Europe to any variable settlement for Scotland. Our dismay on Monday was therefore profound. At a stroke, a hugely self-indulgent stroke at that, the leader of the SNP has alienated Scotland from the whole negotiated Brexit withdrawal process. Who at meetings of the JMC or in Wales, in Northern Ireland, Gibraltar, the Channel Islands or Europe can trust any confidences to the Scottish Government ministers when they have announced so belligerently in advance of any negotiation or agreement that they intend to campaign against it and against our neighbours on these isles? Yes.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can the member recall or has been told of any one instance when the Scottish Government has betrayed confidences of the Westminster Government? Ever?
The Scottish Jackson Government Carwell. Has now made clear its intention is not to support any negotiated agreement, but to seek independence. Of course it can't be treated. But can I say, but can I welcome the Cabinet Secretary back to debates on Europe? I'm delighted that our junior minister is allowing her to participate this afternoon. The Chamber does occasionally want to hear from the organ grinder. Scotland's case, and a vital case at that, will now be all the harder to press, to negotiate or to secure, when the intentions of Scottish Government ministers are not on the deal and prospect.
A wee minute, Mr. Carlock. I know this is a heated debate, but I'm mulling over an organ grinder. I'm not very happy about it, OK?
The boss. The intentions of Scottish Government ministers are not on the deal and prospect, but on the separation they intend to make their life's only true work and priority. This is a tragedy for Scotland. In Scotland's destiny continues to be as 2 million people voted just 2.5 years ago within the United Kingdom, then the SNP will have undermined the potential for Scotland to have any varied relationship with the future EU. This is both an abdication and a disgrace. In its conclusion on intergovernmental relations in our most recent report, the committee made a series of strong recommendations. Across the political spectrum, members recognised both the enormity and complexity of the discussions ahead. On the basis of the counter-briefings received, we gently admonished both governments for allowing a perception to emerge that they had not been working hand in hand. As I've said before, we on this side have noted the reputation of the Scottish Government Minister who has assumed responsibility for these matters for being a pussycat at the JMC meetings and a locker room hero when he pitches up afterwards outside Number 10 or in this chamber to vent his grievances before us all. We noted the Scottish Secretary's commitment to provide a formal written response to the Scottish Government's submission, together with our expectation that this would be published ahead of the lodging of Article 50. We sought agreement to the participation of Scottish Government ministers, not at this point, in negotiations that follow, in bilateral and quadrilateral talks with international partners on new post-withdrawal trading relationships. We talked of a joint ministerial commitment, Committee on International Trade. In other words, we recommended as a committee a Scottish Government involved heart and soul, body and spirit in the multiple strands of work required to negotiate and secure Scotland's interests in the agreement reached to withdraw from the EU. No committee member has argued or concluded that this will be easy. If anything, the extensive engagement we have had since last June has illustrated not just how difficult and fraught it will inevitably prove to be, but has also identified the considerable exceptional legislative burden for which this Parliament will have to prepare. We were ultimately divided on the prospects of continued membership, as the SNP leader has called for, of the single market. Indeed, I've yet to hear any member state diplomat argue that it is achievable and all 27 would have to do so. Yet it was this demand which lay at the centre of the Scottish Government's submission. Was it sincere? Was it all along a plan knowingly doomed to be denied support across Europe? Was it always intended to be an unobtainable objective which the SNP willed the UK government to acknowledge and reject, sowing yet another grievance, but ahead of any EU state delivering the coup de grace? If the SNP were sincere, they would be today working, touring the capitals of Europe, urging EU member states to declare their support for such an idea. But they don't, and we all know why. As according to press reports and senior ministerial sources, the SNP is no longer clear itself what the Scottish Government's actual EU policy would be. It's hard to see how Scotland's interests can be fought for now in these negotiations ahead. Scottish Government ministers have driven a coach and horses through the recommendations in the committee reports and humiliated its convener, Joan McAlpine. Indeed, it's a tragedy. An absolute tragedy, the way that she has been traduced, this loyal backbencher. Yeah. SNP ministers can clearly no longer be trusted in the work ahead. Their ultimatum and objective is now incompatible with almost all the conclusions reached. Presiding officer, there will be debating time aplenty next week to discuss the doomed actions and motivations of the Scottish Government in calling for a second independence referendum. Today, with the Scottish Government's announcement, effectively an abdication of its responsibility in the negotiations ahead, we call on others, those who care about Scotland's place in the UK and the future trading relationships we will enjoy therein, to work together to achieve all that is in best in these EU withdrawal negotiations for Scotland. We can no longer rely on the Scottish Government to achieve that objective.
Thank you, Mr Carlaw. I call Daniel Johnson to open for Labour. 7 minutes, please, Mr Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Clarity and certainty have become rare currency in politics. The issues we faced are defined by disruption so much that we have up until now taken for granted. And that in turn leads to understandable angst, not just in Scotland, nor the UK, but globally. The EU underpins much of how our economy, government and legal system work, and not always in obvious ways. Therefore, the prospect of leaving the EU raises questions where previously we had assumed certainty. Therefore, the committee must be commended for the cool-headed analysis that the reports that they have published undoubtedly represent. These reports are extensive in their scope, they are thorough in their approach, and above all, they are undoubtedly balanced. Many of the topics raised by these reports have been covered in previous debates, but I think it's worth summarising the key points of clarity that I think these reports afford us. The impact of leaving the world's largest free trade area has a fundamental impact on how our economy works and industry operates. Those impacts are counted in jobs and measured in the prosperity of working people. The committee's work is clear and indeed sobering. Their report makes clear that after 10 years, GDP is expected between 2 and 5% lower than it would have been otherwise, and employment between 1 and 3% lower. That's as much as £8 billion taken from our economy, and up to 90,000 jobs lost from the workforce. Edinburgh is home to the second largest financial services centre in the UK, and is a leader for asset management in Europe. Just last week, I visited Standard Life at their headquarters in Edinburgh. The impact of Brexit on this leading employer of thousands of people in the city was made clear and very real. In Germany alone, Standard Life has over 500,000 customers, customers that they are able to serve solely due to the passporting rights that they enjoy by dint of the UK's membership of the European Union. Crashing out of the EU relying on equivalence rules rather than full passporting rights makes serving retail customers and financial services an impossibility. That will force companies to look at relocation, taking with them the high-value, high-wage jobs that the financial services industry provides. And other sectors face similar challenges. The reports highlight the difficulties facing the energy industries, tourism, wholesale and retail trade, amongst others. That will be the real cost of Brexit: jobs, livelihoods and opportunities for industry, businesses and the people that work in them. And whilst on the one hand this loss of jobs is undoubtedly one of the most severe problems we are facing while we contemplate Brexit, we are simultaneously facing a critical loss of labour and access to skills. Freedom of movement within the EU has given us the ability to fill skills gaps as needed to expand our economy's capacity and capability whilst preserving existing standards of employment. The strength of the European Union has been to give us the flexibility to find the skills where we need them, when we need them, allowing people to come and work from throughout Europe to help our economy grow and adapt. But this has been underwritten at the same time by strong regulation guaranteeing working standards and rights at work. And it's not just working standards that the European has guaranteed. The EU is a union that has fostered cooperation and developed shared standards across a broad range of areas. On the environment, we've seen the benefits of international collaboration, with the EU taking action on air quality, climate change, water quality, species protection, and habitat protection. Likewise, in health, we've seen cooperation on pharmaceutical laws and public health initiatives. So while much Eurosceptic bile has been directed over years at European standards of various types of trade, even after Brexit, we will still have to abide by these rules, because if we want to sell our goods and services into Europe, we will have to. But we'll simply have no say over them and have to bear the cost of running parallel bureaucracy and regulation systems here. So this cooperation is embedded into the body of law that we have come to rely on. European institutions, standards and laws that are embedded and intertwined with law and regulation set in Scotland and the UK. As the committee's summary of evidence sets out, 2,029 regulations and 1,070 directives that our law and regulation rely on will need to be reviewed. That represents a legal and technical challenge without precedent that will continue for years, if not decades, following withdrawal from the EU. The importance of the work of this committee has been to set out with clarity the complexity of our relationship. Our economy, our laws, our regulations, our society have become interlinked. Over 40 years of development and cooperation in the European Union means that breaking those bonds, those interdependencies, will bring with them uncertainties and risks, which this report sets out. But this also exposes the faults and inconsistencies in the SNP Scottish Government's logic. It is impossible to discuss these issues and these reports without reflecting on the decisions taken by the First Minister over the last few days. The decision to pursue independence is, according to the First Minister, predicated on withdrawal from the European Union, motivated by these costs and uncertainties and risks. But however great those risks posed to Scotland by withdrawal from the European Union, it is incoherent to argue that those risks are mitigated by seeking to withdraw from another union. In fact, the opposite is true. Separation would double down on those costs and those risks. Our economic bonds with the UK have been developed over 300 years. Our trade worth four times that of European trade. Our legal systems, our social institutions, intertwined and embedded in fundamental ways. So if breaking our bonds with Europe exposes us to risk, the risks and costs of breaking yet more deeper, yet more fundamental bonds with the UK can only be more profound. That is the lesson from these reports. Leaving the European will have consequences, costs, risks that are pronounced and will be counted in jobs and lost prosperity. But to respond to those risks, those costs, by breaking the bonds that we have with the nations with whom we share so much and have even deeper interdependencies simply makes no sense whatsoever.
Thank you. I now move... Can we just calm down a wee bit, please, especially the chorus that's going on in the background. I call Ash Denham to be followed by Rachel Hamilton. Ms Denham, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I draw the attention of the Chamber to the fact that I am PLO to the Cabinet Secretary for Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Affairs. Presiding Officer, while we should no longer be surprised, it is nonetheless alarming to see yet another committee report from this Parliament clearly spelling out how damaging Brexit will be to Scotland. £12.3 billion and 43% of Scotland's international exports go to the EU. That is the economic value, in plain terms, that a hard Tory Brexit seeks to tear Scotland away from. According to the report from the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Affairs Committee, leaving the EU could cost Scottish GDP between £3 billion and £8 billion, and a cut of between 30,000 and 90,000 jobs in the 10 years following the UK's exit. Now, I know such dire numbers have been reported before, and I'm sure that these ones will fall on deaf ears yet again for some in this chamber who would sit complacently by as the UK government seeks to wrench Scotland from the world's single biggest market against its will. The SNP, however, has been anything but complacent. For as the committee concluded, a bespoke solution for Scotland must be considered before and after Article 50 is triggered. Such a solution is precisely what the Scottish Government has worked earnestly to achieve. As was noted in the committee evidence, the Scottish Government was the first constituent part of the UK to deliver a report to set out quite plainly what it wanted and what the options were. And what was Theresa May's approach to Scotland's compromise proposals? Unfortunate and disappointing. Not my words, but those who testified for this committee's report. Dame Mariette Leslie, a former senior diplomat and permanent representative to NATO, commented, quote, "It was extraordinarily unfortunate that the Prime Minister's Lancaster House speech seemed to set the Scottish Government's paper aside when it had not been considered in any detail at the Joint Ministerial Committee." Mike Russell, Minister for UK Negotiations on Scotland's place in Europe, stated in front of the committee that it was a great disappointment that the Prime Minister did not wait to present her government's outline of plans until after they had been discussed with the Joint Ministerial Committee. It is now beyond a doubt that Theresa May and her Tory recruits here at Holyrood give no care at all for the 62% of Scots who voted to remain in the EU, nor will they give an inch of compromise to protect Scotland's place in Europe. Yet here we stand, looking down the barrel of a gun that is Article 50, facing great complexity, great uncertainty, and no bespoke solution emerging for Scotland. As the Scottish Chambers of Commerce testified, the Prime Minister has lacked clarity as to where the country is going, where it will end up, and what its policies are surrounding new free trade agreements between the UK and the EU. Furthermore, the committee received ample evidence from businesses concerned about the uncertainty surrounding the UK's future trading relationship with the EU. Numerous organisations, such as the Royal Town Planning Institute, Highlands and Islands Enterprise, and Construction Scotland, noted reduced investor confidence as a consequence of prolonged Brexit uncertainty. Professor Gordon Masterton at the Institution of Civil Engineers stated that they're operating in a field of uncertainty which represented the worst business and investment risk possible. Professor Masterton urged the committee that this period of uncertainty must be navigated through as quickly as possible. Yet the sheer complexity of a UK outside the EU and renegotiation of trade deals will be anything but quick. As Dr. Margulis of the University of Stirling pointed out, the process of merely renegotiating the market access the UK already has, not additional trade deals, could take years, if not decades. Professor Anton Muscatelli of the University of Glasgow agreed. He noted that the global atmosphere has grown increasingly protectionist. Therefore, the UK must not think that life outside the EU will be a bed of roses. Despite warnings from experts, Greg Hands, UK Minister of State for International Trade, still had the audacity to claim that the UK wants new agreements to be the most comprehensive free trade agreements that anybody has yet negotiated in the world. Well, Mr. Hands, a world-renowned, comprehensive trade agreement has already been reached. It's called the European Single Market, and Scotland is not prepared to be dragged from it and over a disastrous fiscal cliff against its will. Presiding Officer, the conclusions and recommendations in this report give more alarming proof of how destructive Brexit will be. Complacency towards these warnings will only yield calamity. While the Tory and Labour members may be okay with that, I am not. The SNP is not. The Scottish Government is not. And we will do everything in our power to stand against the recklessness of Westminster. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Rachel Hamilton, followed by Richard Lockhead. Ms. Hamilton, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Firstly, may I take this opportunity to reiterate the words of our convener, my colleague Jackson Carlaw, and committee members to thank the clerks for their concerted efforts. As has been mentioned, events following Monday's announcements have sadly deemed much of our committee's work superfluous. For unbeknown to members of the committee, it was the SNP's government's desire to use the decision for the UK to leave the European Union as a call, a reason for a call, for a second independence referendum. Nowhere in the body of this report will you find any suggestion, not one word, not one iota, that Scotland should be independent. Nowhere within this report has the committee recommended to leave the United Kingdom. Much time in the committee has been spent on... Can I make some progress, please, and then I'll take an intervention. Much time in the committee has been spent on discussing options that are not possible. For those reasons, members will note that Jackson Carlaw and I have dissented from parts of this report. Mr. Carlaw and I dissented from the argument, and I quote directly from the final report, moving from full EU membership to the EEA membership would be an easier transition for Scottish businesses than leaving the EU completely, as they would be able to remain in the single market. Membership of the EEA would also allow freedom of movement, which is very important to key parts of the Scottish economy, as well as contributing to Scotland's population growth. It is clear from Brussels and EU experts that there can be no bespoke deal for Scotland. The United Kingdom is the departing member state of the European Union and will negotiate its exit. This means the best deal for Scotland, Wales, England and Northern Ireland. I'll take an intervention at that point.
Joan McAlpine.
Yeah, I thank Rachel Hamilton for taking the intervention. She said that the Europe had ruled out a bespoke deal. In fact, the Constitutional Affairs Committee of the European Parliament, who she knows we met when we were in Brussels, has a report out in which they say that a differentiated deal for Scotland should be considered. And perhaps you would also note the fact that the purpose of the committee's inquiry was nothing to do with Scottish independence. It was looking at Scotland's future in the EU. So it's not really any surprise that the reports don't refer to independence. Thank you.
Rachel Hampton, I thank
Joan McAlpine for that very long intervention. We know that, and you know that Dr. Fabian Zulig said it's very highly unlikely that there'll be a bespoke agreement for Scotland, and so did Charles Grant. The hypocrisy of the SNP and Greens to exude outrage of leaving the single market is almost beyond belief. Let me explain. Because if, presiding officer, if we had become independent in 2014, we would have left the European Union. We would have left the single market, and we would have left the most important trading partner in the single market, the rest of the UK. The report specifically makes this point and states the EU is the largest single market for Scottish exports, out with the UK. Professor Michael Keating said it's not possible. If Scotland was in the single market and the UK was outside, there would be a hard economic border between Scotland and England, which begs the question, why would Scottish businesses cut off their noses to spite their faces? I can't, because I took such a long intervention earlier. I'm sorry, Gillian Martin. People of Scotland, you have witnessed another screeching U-turn. The SNP and Greens are now fanatical about the single market, obsessed with the EU and preoccupied with using anything to hold another divisive independence referendum. Labour and the Liberal Democrats also agreed to the above language, inadvertently promoting a bespoke deal and one that leads itself to undermine Brexit negotiations. Deputy Presiding Officer, I recognise the motives of the Liberal Democrats because their leader and their party want to rerun the referendum and ignore the vote of June 2016. However, I cannot understand Labour because currently nobody gets Labour. Do they support Brexit? Do they support Scottish independence? Both leaders in that respect have shown utter disregard for both results and confused us on where they stand. A vacillating Labour Party leadership must be to blame for pushing our sole Labour Committee member to agree to the idea of a bespoke deal for Scotland. In a minute. In turn, backing the SNP to weaken Brexit negotiations and further their cause for independence. A quick intervention.
Daniel Johnson.
What part of rejecting the need for a referendum and rejecting independence itself does the member not understand? Kezia Dugdale has made the position utterly clear. Would she please not slander in the chamber?
Voted for the referendum, so that just answers your own point. The second conclusion that Jackson Carlaw and I dissented on was speculation, because within the report it uses that very word, and I quote, there is already speculation that the EU may seek to agree the principles of the withdrawal agreement before starting the process of negotiating the future trade agreement. Some have said that the negotiations for the trade agreement could continue for years. Thus, the UK would leave the EU without a new trade agreement in place. On withdrawal, the UK would also no longer be party to the preferential trade agreement that the EU has with third countries. It is vital, therefore, that transitional arrangements be requested by the UK in the Article 50 letter. It is unhelpful to promote further uncertainty in a time of uncertainty. The UK government has proposed phasing arrangements to ensure there is a smooth transition. That is not fantasy nor speculation. That is fact. Let us not forget also the enormous benefit that Scotland has from the UK's network of over 100 countries that promote a solid base for securing strong trade deals. These trading relationships and influence should not be jeopardised. It is better to be at the table than dining alone. To some extent, that is agreed in the report. We agreed that together, as one, as a United Kingdom, we should continue to participate in strong and productive intergovernmental relations. The report recognises that Scottish ministers have participated in negotiations following the prior agreement of a UK negotiating line and set of priorities. And certainly, the participation of Scottish ministers would like to be enjoyed further, although clearly now it seems that Scottish Government would rather try and disrupt negotiations than perhaps positively engage in them. The SNP Government would seem to want to dine alone. Thank you.
Thank you. I have a little time in hand for interventions if members wish to take them, but of course it's up to members. I call Richard Lockhead, followed by David Stewart. Mr. Lockhead.
Thank you. I too thank my fellow committee members for all their hard work on this report, as well as the clerks, the advisers, the witnesses that appeared before us or wrote into the committee and so on, because this is a very important report, as all four reports issued by the committee have been. I think they shine a light on how EU membership is interwoven with Scottish society, right across Scottish society, and our economy, and of course in Scotland's recent past as well. And now our future relationship with Europe is going to be the transcending issue of our time. And just as our forebears were very brave in the post-war environment in Scotland and elsewhere in Europe, in terms of how they reorganised the relationship with each other and created the European Community, and of course the UK joined EFTA, followed by the European Community in the 1970s. Our current generation of politicians equally will have to be courageous, brave and show vision if we are to secure the best, most secure future for the people of Scotland and indeed across the UK and the rest of Europe. And this report, of course, highlighted many of the issues of real importance to Scotland that have to be taken on board before the triggering of Article 50. I do think our reports have found that the work in the reports has been quite challenging given the refusal of David Davis to attend our committee so far. It's pretty outrageous that the biggest challenge facing Scotland since the last war is our relationship with Europe, and yet the Secretary of State for exiting the European Union has not appeared before a Scottish Parliament committee. Likewise, Liam Fox, the Trade Secretary, has also not appeared before our committee, despite our requests as well. And to rub salt into the wound, of course, David Davis's junior minister, David Jones, did agree to appear before the committee and then cancelled his appearance and said he'll come to meet the committee after Article 50 is triggered. That is wholly unacceptable when this is such a big issue facing the people of Scotland. It shows disrespect, it's discourteous, and it's dismissive of Scotland and the Scottish Parliament. Yep.
Adam Tompkin.
How many times has the Secretary of State for Scotland appeared before the committee?
Richard Lockhead.
The Secretary of State for Scotland has appeared before the committee, but we invited the Secretary of State for exiting the European Union on what is described as the biggest challenge facing Scotland since the Second World War. And as I said, it's discourteous and disrespectful that he has not appeared before us. However, he did appear before a committee this morning in the House of Commons. And of course, he's in the headlines for that, because this is probably why he's too embarrassed to appear before the Scottish committee. And it turns out that he has not quantified the cost to the UK of leaving Europe and being left with World Trade Organization rules, despite the fact that Theresa May has said time and time again that no trade deal is better than a bad deal. And of course, he's being slated in the House of Commons and across the media right now as we speak, because it turns out he's not actually quantified the cost to UK of going to WTO rules. He does say he has acknowledged we'll lose financial passports, we'll lose the EU Open Skies Agreement. And of course, when he was challenged by Hilary Benn, he acknowledged that if we do end up with WTO rules, that the meat and dairy producers in Scotland throughout the UK will be hit by tariffs of between 30 and 40%. So as I say, it's absolutely no wonder he's been unwilling to come before the Scottish committee, given that these industries in particular are disproportionately important to Scotland compared to the rest of the UK. Our most recent reports, a committee, however, did address the cost of going to WTO rules as opposed to maintaining links with the single market or the EU. And what the Fraser Allender Institute told us was that GDP in Scotland would go down by 5.3%, exports down by 11.3%, real wages down by 7.2%, and employment down by 3.2%. But I think it's really important, and I think the committee has tried to highlight this, is that we try and see this debate about future generations and about Scotland's long-term future, not just political banter in this chamber or through this current debate, because there are real issues at stake in terms of Scotland's future and Scotland's future generations. Some of the most powerful evidence given to the committee was from Kirsty McLachlan. And to get her title correct, because it means she knows what she's speaking about, she's the Senior Statistician and Head of Demographic Statistics at the National Records of Scotland. And she told us, in terms of the demographic projections, that between 2014 and 2039, the working age population in Scotland will increase by 1% compared to an increase of 13% in England. 1% in Scotland compared to 13% in England. And with zero EU migration, the projections are the UK working age population will increase by 6% and Scotland's working age population will go down by 3%. Down and down by 3%. And if we think that's bad enough, let's look at our projections in terms of the number of Scottish children, which is our future. In terms of between 2014 and 2039, the projections, currently the projection is that the UK figure will go up by 9% and Scotland by 1%. But if we're post-Brexit and there's zero future EU migration, the UK's number of children will go up by 3%, and number of children in Scotland will go down by 5%. So this is about Scotland's future, and it's about future generations, and that's why the committee and many other people in Scotland have found it so important that we do maintain our links with the single market, our membership of the single market, and wider links with Europe. It's also the reason why one of our reports as a committee concluded that the evidence that we have collected shows that the demographic risks to Scotland of a reduction in the number of EU migrants are more acute than for the UK as a whole, and this leads us to conclude that there has to be a bespoke or differentiated solution for immigration policy in Scotland in the future. And that was signed up to by members of the committee. So these are issues that are of profound importance to Scotland's future. And even yesterday morning, I was listening to Good Morning Scotland, and I heard James Hick, the managing director of the Manpower Group, who was talking about companies in Scotland not willing to hire as many people now as what they previously were hoping to do. And what he said was the uncertainty of being able to access labour from outside the UK is causing workers who may have wanted to come to Scotland and the UK to not come in the numbers that they were able to and wanted to come in. That is causing major problems in that sector and in others. So again, this is a huge issue for Scotland's economy. And I just want to finish on another issue the committee picked up on. Which
it
is
must be a sentence or two only, please.
Which is a threat to devolved powers in Scotland. It's really important we all recognise the differentiation between not taking powers we have at the moment and we currently enjoy in this Parliament and stopping powers that should be devolved coming back from Brussels, because the threat is they're not going to come back from Brussels. When I challenged the Secretary of State for Scotland on whether fish quota, for instance, would come back to Scotland, he says he was unwilling to make specific commitments. That's a real threat, and that's why this issue will continue to dominate Scotland to get the best solution for our people's future in the next 2 years.
Thank you. I call David Stewart, followed by Ross Geer. Mr Stewart, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And again, I'd like to thank all the members of the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Relations Committee for the excellent and very thorough reports that they've prepared for us today. Presiding Officer, sometimes events have a horrible habit of raining on our parade, just as the committee made some useful recommendations around Article 52 major factors come into play, which of course have been referred to already. The Article 50 bill cleared the Commons on Monday, and the First Minister announced proposals for the second independence referendum, but more of that next week. Of course, triggering Article 50 takes the UK into uncharted territories. Members will know that no full member has ever left to the EU, so it's very difficult to predict the next steps, but we do have a few clues. Full single market membership is not sought by the UK government, nor likely to be granted because of the gatekeeper condition of the four freedoms would not be met. And we know that the European Commission's Michel Barnier is the chief negotiator and needs to take instructions from the remaining 27 EU countries. The European Parliament, of course, also needs to give the go-ahead for talks. And the final Brexit deal can be ratified by a qualified majority of the other 27 EU leaders, but any new trade deal requires a unanimous vote of all 27 and likely approval by national and, in some cases, regional parliaments, as we know from the CETA deal. So what would the effect be in Scotland? Well, the introductory paragraph of paper 99.1 determining Scotland's future relationship with the EU made the valid point that when we're considering future trading relationships, there are three real models that we need to look at. A future with the EEA and EFTA, a future through the Swiss bilateral agreement, or a future through the World Trade Organization. I'd like to touch on these three models and link in with the evidence taken by the committee. Now, members will know that EFTA was set up in 1960, but of course the UK was a founding member. And when Norway, Liechtenstein and Iceland joined the single market, they became part of the wider European economic area, which include, of course, all the 28 EU members. But they are part of a single market, but they are at arm's length with the EU. So the advantage of this model is if the UK joined, that it avoids the ground zero approach of a sudden dislocation from the single market. However, Presiding Officer, it's not all plain sailing, as you'd expect. Membership of the EEA, as we've heard from Daniel Johnson, is not on par with Scotland's current deal. So financial services would suffer as the three European supervisory agencies on banking, insurance and security markets are not incorporated into that agreement. So for an EEA agreement to work, Britain would require full equivalence from the European supervisory agencies. And there is another problem, colleagues. Ian Dant, the editor of politics.co.uk, said in his recent book, and I quote, "And even when equivalent status is secured, the EU has extraordinary powers to cut the life support at any time. It could withdraw equivalent status whenever it likes, within just a few days. This imbalance of power is reflected in the way that EEA countries are an almost servile state next to the legislative force of the EU. They must accept the rules the EU passes about the single market, but they cannot influence them." However, it's not all doom and gloom. EEA EFTA countries, like Norway, pay less than contributions than full EU members. And the UK, of course, is a net contributor. Norway also has the benefits of a single market, but only just implements over a quarter of EU laws, and also has exemptions from areas of law such as fisheries and justice. Would it not be ironic that the UK go full circle and rejoin EFTA after a 40-year gap and create a two-speed Europe? The second model is the Swiss bilateral. Now, the Swiss deal, as members will know, is very fiendishly complex. They are members of EFTA, but not EEA. They're in the single market, but not the EU nor the customs union. It's a classic example of the Schleswig-Holstein question, as Lord Palmerston, as reported, have said, only three people ever understood it. The Prince Consort who's dead, a German professor who's gone mad, and I, who've forgotten all about it. And it started with a referendum. Sounds familiar. In 1992, Swiss voters rejected the idea of joining the EEA. But the Swiss government thought this was a good idea, the single market. So 6 years later, they got their multiple agreement. But for the Euro bureaucrats, the bespoke model is a fudge and a muddle. They cannot file it under EEA or customs union or Eurozone. It's bespoke with a capital B. Whether Europe will want to go down that road again is open to much debate, Presiding Officer. And the final model...
Cabinet Secretary. Has the member had any indication from the Secretary of State for Scotland or indeed any representative of the UK government whether it is actually this very complicated and challenging model, the Swiss model, that the UK seems to be wanting to go down?
David Stewart.
Yeah, well, my advice, Cabinet Secretary, is that I think the Swiss model was a one-off. I think it was a bespoke. I think it's very difficult. My own personal preference, certainly, in these models, and I'll come to that in a second, certainly the EEA model is an existing, well-trodden path, and that's certainly what I would recommend to Parliament. But the final model is the World Trade Organization. Again, the UK was a founder member in 1965, and, of course, was a founder member of its predecessor body, the General Agreement on Tariffs and Trade, in 1948. So WTO has got 164 members, which is the bulk of world trade of 97%. Now, we're currently members of WTO, and we default to their rules in the event of a hard Brexit. But the sting in the tail of WTO rules is the most favoured nation clause. This means you cannot discriminate in your tariffs. So the UK needs to establish itself within WTO, as currently all the negotiations are being done by the EU on our behalf. What the UK needs to do is create schedules and goods and services. It's a full analysis of how we create with the rest of the world, we trade with the rest of the world, or how the other members would trade with us. We can probably avoid some of the problems with complaints from other countries by following EU external tariffs. But as the convener pointed out earlier, the Fraser-Valander Institute suggested to the committee, in terms of long-term economic downturns to the Scottish economy, in terms of GDP, real wages and employment, if we revert to trade rules under WTO. In conclusion, Brexit is the most fundamental political sea change in my lifetime, but I believe the reports we have today are a first-class analysis of the issues, and I commend them to Parliament.
Thank you very much, Mr. Stewart. I'll need to read your speech afterwards of all these complicated alternatives you were giving. Because I'm one of, you add me to your list that don't understand the Swiss model. Ross Geer to be followed by Emma Harper, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The evidence that our committee has received in recent months has made clear the extent of the confusion and the concern felt across Scotland about what leaving the European Union will entail. And with very few exceptions, it's a matter of the scale of the damage, not whether or not we can avoid it. We have heard from charities, businesses, expert bodies, trade unions, individuals of immense experience, as well as from our constituents directly, and it is overwhelmingly negative. It's clear that in their narrow-minded approach to Brexit, the Westminster government has not given any consideration to Scotland. In fact, it's becoming increasingly clear that they do not know themselves what they're really trying to do. Their approach to Brexit is confused, it's contradictory, and it's dangerous. On trade, we hear of aspirations of a global Britain trading with the world, at the same time as we're to leave the world's largest single market in a hard Brexit. The Tories want to take back control over national sovereignty, at the same time as becoming a global trading nation. The thing is, access to single markets means reducing non-tariff barriers. The EU, the world's largest single market, not only constitutes a significant proportion of global trade, it influences trading standards everywhere. The UK will give up direct input into shaping the very regulations that we'll need to abide by anyway. Indeed, the stated intention of withdrawing from the jurisdiction of the European Court of Justice will likely be incompatible with any meaningful future relationship with the European Union. Trading relationships require arbitration. A trade deal with the EU would almost certainly require having the ECJ as that court of arbitration. Taking back control sounds ever more vacuous. And the contradictions are now matched by absurd rhetoric. Neo-imperialist terms such as Empire 2.0 are bandied about, and just this week, we had the International Trade Secretary trying to rewrite the history of the British Empire at the very same time as he expects to win favourable trade deals with countries still scarred by our colonial oppression. The ignorance of history and of present reality from the Westminster government is dangerous. Protectionist isolationism is not compatible with a global trading nation, and from what we know, neither of these contradictory visions is deliverable or desirable for Scotland or for the UK as a whole. In their rush to mitigate the damage of Brexit, the UK government cozy up to the US administration of Donald Trump. And this won't end well. They intend to cut a deal with a man who's been explicit about putting American corporate interests ahead of all else. Our committee heard the evidence quite clearly. US negotiating style is to put down a trade agreement before you and tell you to sign. The only trading bloc they don't do that with is the European Union. It's too big. And the rhetoric of this being this parliament being one of the world's most powerful sub-state parliaments will look tragically empty when we're faced with UK trade deals that we're set to have no role over approving, all the while our colleagues, such as those in the Belgian state parliaments, can decide the future of the EU's trade deals. The Westminster government's hard Brexit still hangs over citizens of other European nations living here as well, and a threat to them should be seen as a threat to all of us and to the economic, social and cultural health of our society as a whole. Free movement enriches Scotland. As we've heard in committee, sectors across our economy face huge problems if it is restricted. Hotel and restaurant staff, research staff at our world-class universities, seasonal agricultural workers, and many others are drawn from across Europe. Yet the Westminster government have refused to give assurances to EU citizens. They've been prompted repeatedly in the House of Commons, in the Lords, in our committee, and in the chamber of this parliament, each time deciding instead to continue the uncertainty and anxiety faced by over 180,000 people in Scotland and millions across the UK who have chosen to come and live here. EU citizens who want permanent residency face harassment from the British state. Just recently, a German PhD student was threatened with deportation if she did not produce medical insurance documentation. The UK has constructed a bureaucratic nightmare for these people. If EU citizens do wish to attain permanent residency, they must fill out an 85-page form, produced masses of documentation, which have already been mentioned, from the last 5 years of their life, including a diary of every time they've left and re-entered the UK. The situation is so bad that the European Parliament has set up a task force to investigate the UK's treatment of EU citizens. It was also clear to the committee, and I would think to most of us, that the Conservatives are treating Scotland as a whole with contempt. We voted by 62% to 38% to remain in the EU. The Scottish Government published a compromise proposal. Yes.
Rachel Hamilton.
Does the member remember that the voting slip said, should the United Kingdom remain a member of the European Union or leave the European Union? Do you remember this?
I think the member should think out her interventions a bit harder beforehand. Of course, we all remember the question on the ballot paper. Scotland voted for the UK to remain in the European Union. People in Scotland were told in 2014 that voting no was the only way to stay in the European Union. It's all tragically turned out not to be the case. And yet the Scottish Government offered compromise proposals. They published compromise proposals based around EEA membership, going further than what I would have been comfortable with, but trying to come to some kind of understanding with the UK government. They have been roundly ignored. The Scottish Government isn't even aware of when Article 50 is going to be triggered. That is the level of contempt the UK Government treats devolved administrations with. There is no UK-wide approach to Brexit, as was promised. And it is beyond doubt that leaving the EU will directly impact on the devolution settlement. The Supreme Court have already attested to it. Yet the UK Government have refused to apply the Seoul Convention. This is a constitutional crisis of their making. It's clear that Scotland's vote to remain in the EU is being ignored. The UK that Scotland voted to stay part of in 2014 no longer exists.
Members, in his last minute, in fact, we need to start winding up, Mr. Greer.
In its place is a country that is becoming increasingly inward-looking and regressive, that has turned its back on its European partners and tilted back towards a subservient relationship with the new American administration. Scotland must choose whether that is a future that we want to be part of, or whether we want to put our future in our own hands.
Thank you very much. I call Emma Harper to follow Alexander Stewart. Ms. Harper, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to remind the Chamber that I am the liaison officer for the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Economy and Connectivity. And the points that I'm about to make are focused on the future relationship of Scotland, UK and the EU with our agriculture sector. The opening sentences from the latest European Committee report say, in the 43 years that the UK has been part of the European Union, Scotland has benefited from increasing trade opportunities. The EU is now the single largest market for Scottish exports out with the UK. I'm a member of the European Committee, and the committee has heard lots of evidence and expert opinion from witnesses, and many thanks are due to the committee convener, and the members and the clerks for their diligent work on all the reports, and additional thanks go to Professor Michael Keaton and Dr. Shona Douglas-Scott for their expertise and input as well. I'd like to make a couple of points related to agriculture. We need to be quite clear as to what the aim for negotiations for agriculture in the form of trade, tariffs and support, i.e. CAP replacement, will be 24 months from now, March 2019. In our evidence, we heard from Peter Hardwick of the Agriculture and Horticultural Development Board, and he told us that of all the sectors, agriculture proved to be one of the most challenging of trade agreements and negotiations. Agriculture was always concluded at the end because it is the most difficult bit. Mr. Hardwick argued that in regard to trade negotiations in agriculture, he could not see a solution that delivers what the sector needs if it includes tariffs. His most crucial point is that ongoing tariff-free access for the export of beef and lamb is essential for us in Scotland. Of course I will.
I'd just like to ask the member whether she'd be happy if Scotland was to remain within the common agriculture policy and the common fisheries policy.
Emma Harper.
We've talked about common agricultural policy and fishing policy in previous debates, and I think the CFP obviously has to have some amendments and changes made, and it isn't a policy that the SNP or has ever supported. So thank you for your intervention. Mr. Hardwick, he argued that in regards to trade negotiations, the sector needs no tariffs. His most crucial point is what I just mentioned, And this morning, the Secretary of State for Leaving the EU, David Davis, he confirmed what many in the industry have suspected, and that there will be tariffs of at least 30 to 40% in the beef and dairy industry. Evidence that the committee heard exposed the potential for a significant risk to various EU funding streams, Horizon 2020, leader funding, NUTS 2, and agricultural support is a particular focus for me. It's not yet clear whether the UK government will provide support and funding policies to the same extent as the European Union supports agribusiness currently. If the future framework for funding is determined by population share rather than the current allocation system, then Scotland's agricultural sector would see a reduction from 18% support to a meagre 8%. This translates to hundreds of millions of pounds of support vanishing. Farming and agribusiness in Scotland is vital for our rural economy. Cabinet Secretary Fergus Ewing is correct when he refers to the farmers as custodians of the countryside. These custodians are folk who grow our food, rear the beasts, and look after the land. They are crucial for the rural economy, and they actually spend their money locally, contributing to the sustainability of our rural communities. I've been out and about speaking to many local rural and agricultural business folk and farmers since the vote to remove us from Europe. We do have an opportunity to revert to World Trade Organization options for trade agreements, but if we do that, we all need to understand that this means no subsidies for agriculture, no support. I've already taken an intervention. I need to proceed because I will run out of time. No support, that is the WTO rules. The only trade agreement that allows subsidy of farmers is the trade deal with the EU, and we're about to leave it. Last week, as part of committee work, I was speaking to one of the Conservative members of the London Assembly here in Parliament. I was telling him that Scotland has 974 dairy farms, and 48% of them are in Dumfries and Galloway. And in recent years, many of the dairymen hail from Eastern European countries such as Romania, Lithuania and Poland. I was relaying this information to my Conservative visitor because I was curious what his perspective from London would be as to how we could recruit replacement dairymen if Prime Minister Theresa May fails to guarantee EU citizens the right to remain as residents in the UK, even if the people have been here for 5 or even 10 years. His solution for replacing the dairymen was that we need to just find unemployed people from Sunderland, take them from their homes, ship them to Scotland, and expect them to work as dairymen in a job that they have no skills for. So that's the answer. Simple. Just force folk to up sticks and move from their homes, their families, and their communities. It's completely disrespectful to the dairy industry to assume that being a dairyman is an unskilled job. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, whatever happens during the post-Article 50 negotiations, I ask the Scottish Government to continuously pressure the UK Government to acknowledge the democratic will of my constituents, your constituents, even the constituents across the Chamber who represent the 62% of people in Scotland who voted to remain in the Union of Free Nations. Presiding Officer, I ask that both governments keep the Scottish folk and agribusiness informed, included and involved about progress regarding the EU exit. I remain committed to Max Sicker that the best deal will be achieved for Scotland.
I call Alexander Stewart to be followed by Tavish Scott.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'd like to acknowledge the work of the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Relations Committee, who have diligently taken evidence from ministers both here at Holyrood and Westminster and have travelled to Brussels to engage and discuss many aspects relating to the debate this afternoon. The committee took evidence from individuals, from groups, from organisations, and they looked at sectors like agriculture, tourism, fisheries and the economy. I'd also like to pay tribute to the members of the committee who worked diligently in their endeavours. And as I said, individuals gave of their time and their talents to support that committee, to ensure that they came up with good recommendations. And we have seen that, Deputy Presiding Officer, today. The reports have come forward. So individuals worked in good faith to ensure that these recommendations were what the committee believed and what they wanted the public in Scotland and this Parliament to see. But Deputy Presiding Officer, as many members have already pointed out in the debate, This takes place in the aftermath of the First Minister's betrayal to the people of Scotland, who only two short years ago made it clear their desire to remain a strong and integral part of the United Kingdom. Not quite yet, I'll take you later. They did so in full acknowledgement of the fact that the then Prime Minister made the pledge to hold a referendum on the United Kingdom's membership of the European Union. In fact, Scotland's future, which was seen by many people as a taxpayers-funded SNP manifesto published prior to that referendum, talked about if we were to remain in the UK, the Conservative Party's promise of an in-out referendum on the EU membership raised a serious possibility that Scotland may well come out of the EU, and that was within that document. Much like the SNP's whole approach to politics and the way going forward, the people of Britain wish to leave, and that has taken place. And as I say, we have to respect that in this whole context that we're working with. And after 2 years, the division and the divisive debate that took place along that has left us with a situation. And we know, Deputy Presiding Officer, that there is a neglect from our public services, and neither of the people in Scotland want to go back to any of these processes that take place. The Scottish National Party have once again turned to their comfort blanket of independence at any cost, and it is there to ensure that their utterly abysmal record in government and their lack of attention and lack of involvement. You know, as we've said and we discussed... Thank you. I will.
Ash Denham.
I have a question for the member, and I'm wondering how many jobs would have to be predicted to be lost in Scotland before the Conservatives would act and stand up for Scotland? 30,000, 40,000, 80,000. How many?
Alexander Stewart.
Ash Denham, Deputy Presiding Officer, you need to think about independence. If you were making independence...
Speak through the chair, please.
Deputy Presiding Officer, independence would cost tens of thousands of jobs. We already have seen, even over the last few days, I've heard from constituents who are cancelling orders, who are unhappy about the way going forward, and that is making a massive impact on our economy now because of your action of your First Minister. So, as I say, let's think long and hard. You know, let's look at the world we live in. You know, we were known in this country, Deputy Presiding Officer, to lead the world when it came to education. And education was discussed in this committee on many times. For example, we now don't even lead education within the UK. It's almost every endeavour and every policy that the nationalists bring forward are to cause division and to cause instability, as within... No, I've taken one already. I want to make progress. If the Scottish Government really want to get the best deal for Scotland in the imminent negotiations with the European partners, they should take the threat of an independence referendum off that table, because that shows us where we really are. And while Mike Russell, and I see he's no longer in the chamber, and his colleagues profess to have done everything within their power to fight for Scottish interests when they're going forward, they have completely changed that view. They want to work, they want to ensure going forward that there were unworkable and unpractical suggestions and solutions that they were dealing with when they were sitting with the UK government. And as has been mentioned already, they didn't create a big issue at the table, but when they come outside and they see the media, that's where they want to create the issue. It is that domestic market that we have, that we know is so important to Scotland, and it is that domestic market which is four times as good in the goods and services that we have within the EU. Only members situated in the central benches of this chamber could argue that EU single market is more important to Scotland than the UK domestic market, and keep a straight face, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Absolutely.
Our Prime Minister, Theresa May, has made it absolutely categorically clear that she will insist on negotiating a Brexit that works for the whole of the United Kingdom. And if the SNP stopped their posturing and just thought for 1 minute that they might actually want to work together, we might find some common ground here which might work for the people of Scotland and the people of the United Kingdom. The approach taken by the Scottish Government thus far has been entirely divisive. They want to cause as much difficulty as they can, and that was just a platform for the First Minister to make her announcement yesterday. The opportunities of agricultural, fisheries and trade that now present themselves as we depart the political structure of the European Union are immense, and we've seen that. And some individuals who gave evidence ensured that took the place. To conclude, Deputy Presiding Officer, as someone who campaigned to leave, I accept that there will be challenges as we go forward. No one has ever suggested otherwise, but no challenge presented by Brexit is solved by independence, and no government should do all within their power to stymie debate as we go forward. And as I say, the SNP should add their part to ensure that the Brexit works for everybody in this United Kingdom, and Scotland can do well from it. And I support the recommendations that's come from the report. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Right, I have to be really strict with time for the last speeches. We're really pushed. Tavish Scott, followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you, Officer, by thanking Daniel Johnson for making a genuinely pro-European speech. In his first 5 minutes, he set out exactly what Labour had been missing. And if I may say so, if he'd been making that kind of contribution, we wouldn't be quite in the mess we were, given Jeremy Corbyn's complete inability to make a speech in favour of the European Union. So I'd like to genuinely thank Daniel Johnson for doing exactly what should be coming from his benches down at Westminster and sadly wasn't. I'd also like to begin by thanking the clerks, as other committee colleagues have, and actually committee colleagues too, for pulling together a report, which I must confess I did not necessarily believe would be possible at the start of that particular Thursday morning at 8 a.m, if I remember correctly. Two wider points. There are Dutch elections going on today, Deputy Presiding Officer, and if I, as a pro-European, wish anything, it is that Mark Rutte is re-elected and stems the tide of alt-truth, of right-wing anti-immigration populism. And secondly, when I saw on Twitter last night the flow of requests for money on both sides of the debate, and then the very next minute, 10 minutes later, into the news at the back of 10 o'clock, the millions of people who are facing famine in Africa, I just hope that at times here in Scotland we remember to look outwards rather than looking inwards, given the destitution that people face in other parts of the world. I just really want to make a number of points about this matter as to where we are now, because others have already commented, in my view, correctly, that committee reports come and go and some gather dust. This one gathered dust instantly within 3 or 4 days because of what's happened in the last couple of days. But this was not caused by Nicola Sturgeon or indeed even Theresa May, but by David Cameron, because it was his gamble to buy off the Conservative Party to try and mend a historic split in that party that has caused the unholy mess that this country's... No, I'm going to finish this point, then I'll very happily give way. ...has caused the unholy mess that we're now in. And I suspect history will be very, very unkind on David Cameron's premiership. And if Adam Tompkins wants to argue with that, he's welcome to.
Adam Tompkins.
Mr. Scott, a question, if I may, and that is whether it is now Liberal Democrat policy to have fewer referendums or more referendums, because he seems to be wanting to have another referendum to reverse the result of June 2016, despite the fact that he thinks that holding that referendum was a mistake. So which is it? Should we have more referendums in this country or should we have fewer?
Tavish Scott.
Well, I haven't even mentioned referendums yet, and Mr. Tompkins is off on one on it. I'll deal with that in a few moments. Mike Russell began by saying that leaving the European Union was profoundly damaging, which is indeed absolutely true, not just for Scotland, of course, but for the whole of the United Kingdom. A number of times that this committee has heard evidence from London about the damage to the financial centres of London, which link, of course, to Edinburgh and Glasgow and to Aberdeen, not least of which because of recent mergers that have just taken place across financial services, is very considerable indeed. Mike Russell also said that some of the impact is already beginning to be felt and mentioned democracy and mandate. Two gentle remarks to Mike Russell, although he's not here, on democracy. I saw him on television last night talking about democracy and the importance of democracy. Well, that's of course true, and he makes a fair point, but he must make a fair point too about this Parliament passing motions on Highlands Islands Enterprise, on the Scottish Funding Council, and on education policy as well. So let's just be tight on our definition of when Parliaments say things and when Parliaments don't say things. And secondly, on mandate, well, we've all got a mandate. I have a mandate as well. I was elected in Shetland on standing up and making the case for the European Union and standing up against a second referendum in independence. So Mike Russell and his party quite understandably believe that. They stood on their mandate to make that case, but they at very least need to recognise and respect the fact that most those of us on other sides absolutely did not, and we're therefore going to make that case. I fear most of all in all of this, Presiding Officer, Scotland leaving the UK and the UK as a whole leaving the EU. That would be the worst of all worlds, and I fear that not for me because, frankly, by the time all this happens, or if it happens, or whatever happens, I'll be at that stage that Gordon Wilson was in last night on the telly, where he's trotted out as an old man of politics to opine on the latest development and conducts that very elegant old statesman U-turn to then support his party. Well, no doubt we'll all get into that point in, well, it's more difficult for a Liberal because, anyway, but at some point we'll all be in that particular place. But I fear being out of Europe and out of the UK for my children, for the next generation, because my kids are pro-Europeans. I go to school classes regularly around, not just in Shetland, but with the Education Committee that I'm honoured to be part of in this Parliament, to other schools across Scotland and meet young people who are European in their outlook. And I think this huge decision that the UK government have taken is, as has already been said, profoundly damaging. But it is why. It is why when all these remarks about clarity are made, it is why that if we are to have, and the Greens are going to vote for it, so assuredly next week, that will happen. There will be a parliamentary majority in this place for a second referendum. Why there needs to be a decision made with the full knowledge of what has happened. And therefore, to say, as the First Minister said, that the referendum must take place within a precise period of time before the outcome of Brexit is known, I believe is wrong, and wrong for this reason. Anyone who knows anything about the tortuous negotiations of the European Union know nothing is agreed till all is agreed. And it will be only at the very last minute that is understood and that is known. And therefore, it is only right that the people of Scotland, if they are going to be subjected to another referendum on this nation's constitutional future, it's only right they know exactly what has happened in those Brexit negotiations.
Call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Ross Thompson. Can I remind you that we're very pushed for time?
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. First of all, I would like to commend the reports to the Parliament and also like to express my thanks to colleagues from across the Chamber, our excellent clerking team, our advisers and also everyone who has provided evidence. But I do believe that these reports will actually help many in actually trying to understand some of the key issues that Scotland and UK face as we venture headlong into this Brexit process. As yet, Article 50 hasn't been triggered, but we know it could happen any day now. And I would like to echo the comments of some and ask the Prime Minister to at least respect the 25th of March as the anniversary of the Treaty of Rome. Please, Prime Minister, do not trigger Article 50 then or any day before or after. Let those Europeans who actually do care about the EU enjoy their day. Respecting the 25th of March will garner some credibility for the UK government, which certainly at the moment is very much in short supply. Now, I say short supply, as comments from the Foreign Secretary will not help. Boris Johnson's attempt at claiming the EU and Hitler was ill-advised, to say the least. Quoting, Napoleon, Hitler, various people try this out and it ends tragically. The EU is an attempt to do this by different methods. But fundamentally, what is lacking is the eternal problem, which is that there is no underlying loyalty to the idea of Europe. Now, Presiding Officer, that type of comment from the Foreign Secretary of the UK is ill-advised, to say the least. And Sir Alexander Stewart, well, he's left the chamber, he actually spoke earlier on about being divisive. I would argue the comments from the Foreign Secretary are utterly divisive when it comes to that type of comparison. Now, certainly also Rachel Hamilton commented earlier on as well regarding in a time of uncertainty. Comments from the Foreign Secretary actually, unfortunately, aid that issue of uncertainty when it comes to the economy, and also certainly takes away that element of respect that the UK government's currently got within the EU. Presiding Officer, our committee has produced four excellent reports, and I've got no hesitation in highlighting them when I actually talk to constituents, local businesses, or anyone with an interest. With political interest in Scotland at such an increased level, which I welcome, I'm sure MSPs from across the chamber will welcome, I hope we can actually highlight the various points in the reports. But, Presiding Officer, during an evidence session On the 22nd of February, our committee took evidence from the Right Honourable Greg Hands MP, the Minister of State for Trade and Investment. And during questioning from my colleague Emma Harper, MSP, Mr Hands stated, and I quote, in 2015, Scotland secured a total of 119 foreign direct investment projects, which makes it the second most attractive region in the UK behind only London. Now, this somewhat let the cat out of the bag regarding the UK government's position and thinking about Scotland. Presiding officer, Scotland is not a region. Scotland is a nation. Now, I gently asked the minister at the time to reconsider his comments, and he replied with what can only be described as a supercilious reply. Now, I don't blame him. I generally don't blame him, however. It's the culture of the Westminster bubble which considers Scotland as an irrelevance at worst and an annoyance at best. I'll take your intervention.
Adam Tompkins.
Go to the member for giving way. Scotland is, of course, a nation. We all are agreed on that on all benches in this chamber. But as a matter of European law, Scotland is classified as a region.
Stuart McMillan.
Mr Tompkins, Mr Hands, the minister, was talking about foreign direct investment in a UK sense. And in that aspect, Scotland, Mr Tompkins is absolutely correct, Scotland is a nation. But please, Mr Tompkins, tell that to your ministers down in London. Please tell them, because they don't know, they don't respect Scotland. Presiding officer, the people of Scotland did not vote for Brexit, and only one of the nation's 59 MPs has now backed the UK government by voting for the triggering of Article 50. And I don't want Scotland to lose the estimated 80,000 jobs within a decade, or cost people an average of £2,000 in wages, as indicated by the Fraser Valander report, who our committee commissioned to undertake research. So, you know, officer, I don't want Scotland to be ignored any longer. And if Scotland can be ignored on an issue of such magnitude and importance as our membership of the European Union and the single market, then it's clear our voice and our interests can be ignored at any time by the UK government. And, presiding officer, we are not going back into our box. And the politics of the past is no longer acceptable to the electorate in Scotland. And the recent report our committee published, entitled Determining Scotland's Future Relationship with the European Union, is one which I believe clearly highlights the position of many people across Scotland. Our key recommendation, calling for a bespoke solution for Scotland, is not something I would think many people would wish to argue against. It has caused debate, however, but clearly not at UK level, as they appear to have ignored the compromise suggestion by the Scottish Government in December. And Rachel Hamilton spoke earlier on regarding a bespoke solution being highly unlikely. Well, I'm sure decades and decades ago, when people first thought of actually going to the moon and sending rockets up into space, people probably thought that was highly unlikely. But did it stop them from trying? No, it did not. So we should not stop trying, looking for a bespoke solution for Scotland. This isn't a compromise suggestion. No, I'm in my last minute. This isn't a compromise suggestion to make Scotland different. It's a compromise to actually help our economy and help the people who actually live in Scotland. And the further recommendation was that exploring EEA membership with the EU27 before and after triggering of Article 50. There have been many comments in recent months about the opportunity Brexit provides, but I would argue the opportunity for Scotland and the UK to have that differential position. Our committee recognised that there is no direct precedent for achieving any type of solution of this nature, but there already exists a variety of differential agreements within the EU, and the Faroe Islands and Denmark was one example. Now, presiding officer, I'm conscious of time, and you're going to stop me, but I would just finally say I would like to...
No, please, Mr McMillan, we are seriously
I'll be supporting
pushed.
The motion tonight. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr McMillan. Before I call anyone else, can I say that it's the presiding officer's quite strict rule that members should stay in the chamber for at least two speeches after their own, unless they have asked the presiding officer otherwise and been given permission to do so. I'm sure Mr Alexander Stewart will apologise when he comes back into the chamber. And meanwhile, I call Ross Thompson to be followed by Christina McKelvey.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I would also like to thank the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Relations Committee for its work and for bringing forward this debate. Most strikingly, the committee's report calls for engagement from across Scotland. This is encouraging and demonstrates the importance of bringing people together to establish facts, challenges, solutions and opportunities from exiting the European Union. However, after Monday morning's announcement from the First Minister, it is all but apparent that this type of constructive engagement is the last thing on the Scottish Government's agenda. The Government would rather pursue another divisive independence referendum than explore the numerous opportunities for Scotland which Brexit presents. It couldn't be clearer that the government's so-called compromise proposals, compromise proposals were never genuine or sincere. Instead, they were just another move in the SNP's independence game plan. But as the Prime Minister herself has said, politics is not a game. The lives of our people are not a game. The prosperity of our businesses and our industries is not a game. No, thank you. The security of people's jobs is not a game. The future of our country is not a game. I've lost count of the people who have contacted me from across Scotland since Monday to express their dismay and anger. This anger is particularly potent from the North East fishing communities. Now, as the convener of the committee mentioned in her opening remarks, she stated the challenges facing fishermen, and the report reflects the evidence that the committee has heard. But let's be clear that the Scottish Fishermen's Federation has been unequivocal in its support for the UK government's approach to leaving the EU. Bertie Armstrong, the chief executive of the Fishermen's Federation, has reiterated that the Scottish government are, and I quote, making the wrong argument at the wrong time when it comes to independence. Imagine the palpable frustration from fishermen who now fear that the SNP will sell out their industry and coastal communities by dragging them back into the EU, back into the common fisheries policy. Alec Neil is absolutely right. The SNP and any pro-independence campaign will hemorrhage votes in the North East if they continue to disregard the legitimate views of Leave voters. Now, Deputy Presiding Officer, as David Stewart highlighted in his own remarks, and a theme within the report is about EFTA membership and that being an option for Scotland. Well, maybe it was the wise words of wisdom from Alec Neil that have led to the total and utter chaos we've seen in the SNP today, with reports that they are now considering ditching their policy on supporting full EU membership in favour of a Norway-style deal. Just a day after the First Minister demanded a second vote on independence, senior nationalist sources told the Daily Telegraph that Nicola Sturgeon would try to join the European Free Trade Association. This is despite only yesterday Mike Russell stating in this place that the SNP remains in favour of full EU membership. Even senior SNP figures can't seem to agree on what relationship they should have with the EU. What makes this whole fiasco even more extraordinary is that the First Minister herself stated in July last year that the EFTA option would leave Scotland with no influence. In fact, I quote, and I hope Alec Neil and his Brexit colleagues are listening, is to end up in a position which is highly possible, where we have to abide by all the rules of the single market and pay to be part of it, but have no say whatsoever in what the rules are, would not be taking back control, to coin a phrase we've heard more than once recently, it would be giving up control. Having an influence in the world we live in matters for all of us. That is Nicola Sturgeon. Whilst the Prime Minister attempts to negotiate bold, ambitious free trade deals with the EU and others, the Scottish Government continues to overinflate the importance of the single market, conveniently sidestepping the fact that the UK's biggest trading partner is the rest of the UK. But, Deputy Presiding Officer, the SNP's contempt for cold, hard facts, economic reality, and the benefits of Brexit should come as no surprise to anyone in this place. Deputy Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government have abdicated responsibility.
I think it's quite clear that Mr. Thompson's not taking interventions. Yes. Can we have a wee bit of calm, please, Mr. Thompson?
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Deputy Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government have abdicated their responsibility to promote Scotland's interests in the negotiations to come, and instead will be actively
Mr. Thompson, carry on.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. They will be actively and aggressively talking down the UK government's efforts to achieve the best deal for the whole of the United Kingdom. It's up to the rest of us to stand up for the democratic decisions we have all made as a country. The Scottish Conservatives can and will do just that. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
The last of the open speakers is Christina McKelvey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Reports, reports, reports. By the time the Prime Minister triggers Article 50, there will already be a library full of views, considerations, discussion minutes and research files. Some are genuinely useful and intelligent, like this one. Others pull together thinly veiled propaganda that represents, as my colleague Stephen Gethin's MP said, a dereliction of duty. This is what happens when there's a vacuum, when a government completely fails to provide readable, accessible, objective information. The other thing that happens is that a vacuum creates a space in which some very extremist people develop the status of heroes. Vacuums are dangerous. So first, I want to congratulate the committee for being both accessible and readable in this report. Together, they have distilled down a wide range of very different perceptions into a document that is very practical and real. We hear the voices, we get the issues, and we digest and respond. Colleagues have already spoken at length, and at length we've had anger from the Tory benches. Whether it's righteous or not, will remain to be seen. But at length, regarding the difficulties up ahead in securing sustainable trade deals post-Brexit, we are standing on the cliff edge, about to say goodbye to all the riches Europe has brought us during these last decades. And the Brexiteers, well, they're waving their hats, cheering for the end for those four fundamental trade freedoms: the freedom of movement of goods, the freedom of movement of workers, the right to establish and freedom to provide services, and the freedom of movement of capital. To not even give EU nationals reassurance on Monday is a disgusting act in itself, and it's not the country that I live in. And while they cheer under the delusion that they are going to be living a land flowing of milk and honey, they are blind to the end of everything, from a legal guarantee of human rights and social protection, the support of major national partners, and in the event of war, and an end to cap payments. It's like setting fire to your own house and cheering the destruction as the roof blows up. These four freedoms, Presiding Officer, have a series of associated social protections, particularly in the freedom of movement part. We in this government and across Europe are working hard and indeed have been very successful in our drive to protect against human trafficking, discrimination, violence against women and girls, and LGBTI bullying and abuse. Very many support groups such as Women's Aid, Enable, Engender, Money Advice Scotland, Stonewall, and many, many other organisations, including disability rights groups, follow carefully what we are achieving and commend us for it, this Parliament. And as convener of the Equalities and Human Rights Committee, I am participating in those important changes constantly. We have set ourselves goals that represent who we are and the kind of country that we want to live and play a part in. We are global citizens, Presiding Officers, who happen to live in a forward-thinking, innovative, protecting and compassionate society. That we are citizens of Europe puts us into that huge and disparate group of some 60 million people, the vast majority of whom share our ideals and values. I hate to look forward to the prospect of a passport that no longer says citizen of the European Union. I do look forward to one that says citizen of Scotland and the European Union, though. And when it comes to the very nasty aspects of today's reality, terrorist bombs in France, Belgium, Germany, and even Glasgow, cruel and destructive actions against refugees, not just across Europe, but by this government in the UK, human trafficking, torture, FGM, I could go on and on. These things we tackle together with the strength and the impact of not only 28, maybe soon to be 27 countries, but with the central core of legislation that protects workers' rights through the Working Time Directive, through holiday leave entitlement, maternity rights, equal pay and sickness benefits, and of course the right not to be discriminated against or even tortured. But let's take one of those rights, the right to healthcare whilst on holiday. And in committee today, when asked, David Davis said he could not confirm if UK citizens will no longer have access to the EHIC health card. He said, and I quote, "Probably, I haven't looked at it." That seems to sum up this UK government entirely. Probably, but I haven't looked at it. And as reported widely today, the Westminster government is ill-prepared for dealing with the implications of leaving the EU at any level. Some of its members have overtly lied to the public and others have misled. There is no such truth to be found because the truth is too awful to talk about. That's why Davis has admitted that he has no plan A, B, C or even Z. The way forward is certainly paved with good intentions, I hope, presiding officer, but an awful lot of challenges. Scotland will make its presence felt. We will demand recognition at the negotiating table and we will fight for the representation of our people. Ultimately, presiding officer, Scots will make their own decision about this kind of society they want to be part of and how they want to make that work. I know which side I'll be on.
We now move to the closing speeches. I'm disappointed to see that not all members who took part in the debate are back in the chamber. Meanwhile, I call on Daniel Johnson. Up to 6 minutes, please, Mr. Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. This has been at times a contentious debate, a fraught debate, and I think that is kind of not surprising given the subject matter that we are discussing and the context within which we're having this debate. But there are some common threads, so let me begin with consensus. I think, first and foremost, let me reiterate my thanks to the committee. This committee's work and the clarity and hard work that has gone into the reports, I think, are valuable. These reports are useful. Indeed, I'd also just like to mention, I think Richard Lockhead, I think, said something very important, that the EU has been the context for the current political generation. And whatever our points of view, whatever our perspectives, I think his point that we need to think about future generations is absolutely right. So I think there are three principal points that have been discussed. I think one is about the impact of economy and jobs, the impact on people, and the options that we have. But before I go any further, I would also just like to thank Tavish Scott for his kind words about what I said, because I think whatever happens, whatever option this country takes, either the UK or Scotland, I think is incumbent on all of us who are pro-Europeans to continue to make the case for Europe. And I, for one, am committed to making the case for the UK's participation in Europe, and indeed the case for the European Union beyond whatever happens through Article 50 and the exit of the UK from the European Union. That's my personal commitment. So let me talk briefly about the impact on jobs and money. I don't want to cover the ground in depth, but clearly there is going to be a huge impact on jobs. That has got to be our fundamental consideration. And again, I think there is consensus in that. But we also have to recognise the compromises that are made, moving from a situation of deeper cooperation to the compromises that we need to make through trade deals. And there are also areas which we've not discussed. The impact on universities and the funding for research is profound. That has impacts both on jobs directly, but also, I think, the wider benefits. Indeed, I think agriculture has been mentioned by one or two members, but it is an area of huge complexity and one which requires our attention. Indeed, I think we should also just reiterate that the brutal impacts outlined by the Fraser of Allender numbers, and a number of speakers have mentioned them, but the prospect of basically crashing out of the European Union on WTO rules with the impact of GDP of a decline of 5.3%, exports down by 11.3%, employment down by 7.2%. These are circumstances that we cannot accept. We also need to... briefly...
Joan McAlpine.
I thank the member for taking an intervention and I agree with the points that he's made about WTO rules. Does he also agree with the chief economist of Quality Meat Scotland when he pointed out that a carcass of lamb under WTO rules, the tariff on it will increase by 49%, so that a carcass selling for £80 will go up to something like £119 under WTO rules?
Daniel Johnson.
Well, I wouldn't pretend to know the detail, but I mean, I think those are exactly the sorts of tariffs and conditions on trade that we need to look at. And I'll come onto this later. We also need to look at the people impacts. And I think Christina McKelvey made a very impassioned speech, but the real impacts, that this is people's lives that we're talking about. There are people who've made their lives in this country who are being treated by the government as a bargaining chip. I think it's absurd that the UK government didn't accept Harriet Harman's amendment, looking at basically ensuring that people who are already here can stay here. Now, what is the cost? There's no concession there. I understand the need to bargain about the rights of EU citizens in the future, but the ones who are already here, surely we can extend them those rights. But this is about Scotland's options going forward, and I'd thank my colleague Dave Stewart for his very thorough explanation of the three different options, that there are costs and downsides to each of them. Even the EEA EFTA model is not without complications or downsides. The cost of the financial services sector will be profound. The Swiss model is probably unrepeatable, and the WTO rule I think I've already mentioned. Indeed, I think Ross Greer pointed out quite correctly that this concept of a global trading nation means accepting the restrictions and tariffs placed upon us. But we also need to look at the Scottish Government's so-called alternative model. And I think it's important that we do explore every opportunity to maintain our links and access and membership of the single market. But to simply present their option as a concrete, sure model that we can just take off the shelf is not the case. The committee's own report makes that clear. Dag Werner Holler from EFTA, and I quote, said, "There have been no concrete, direct discussions either between EFTA states or between the Faroe Islands on that matter in any substantial way." So to stand in front of us and claim that there is an option there that can be taken easy, swiftly, and without cost or consequence is simply a nonsense.
Mike Russell.
Fair, you will find it throughout the paper, Scotland's Place in Europe, references to the difficulties of moving forward on any of these options, including the UK option. I'm sure the member would like to be fair about that. I'd be happy to send the references to him.
Daniel Johnson.
Let me be fair. That is what the paper says. But it's not the words that are uttered by the government ministers when describing the paper. It's presented as a certainty, and that is unfair. It is dishonest. And it is also dishonest to talk about the jobs and economic costs of coming out of the EU without acknowledging the costs and implications of coming out of the United Kingdom. Because if there are costs and implications and risks from coming out of the EU, from destroying those bonds that we have with the rest of the European Union, those costs, those risks are many times, many fold over if we're coming out of the UK. And that is the realistic, honest assessment that we have to have if we're discussing independence. And finally,
no,
to Rachel
no,
Hamilton's
Mr. Johnson, point, I'm afraid you have to close. We're pushed for time.
Well, that is why Labour rejects independence and rejects the need for a second independence referendum. And on that point, I'll close.
I call Adam Tompkins. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'd like to start also by praising the committee's work and by thanking all of the members from all parties who serve on the committee, as well as the parliamentary staff. The committee's work is impressive in terms of its quantity, and it's also impressive in terms of its quality. It's rich and it's full. But as David Stewart rather eloquently put it in his remarks earlier on, events have a horrible habit of raining on our parade or raining on the committee's parade. And I do rather share my friend and colleague Jackson Carlow's sympathy with the convener Joan McAlpine at having the rug pulled out from underneath her by the First Minister on Monday. From the richness of this work, I wanted to try and pull out, if I can, in these remarks, three broad themes, each of which I think has been reflected in the debate that we've had this afternoon. The first is this theme of opportunity versus risk. And Richard Lockhead put something very strikingly in his speech this afternoon. He said, and he was right to say it, that the creation of the European Union was an act of political bravery in the immediate post-war era of European politics. He's right about that. And what we now need, Deputy Presiding Officer, is to be equally brave and equally bold in our advocacy of the relationship that we as the United Kingdom should have, not only with the rest of Europe, not only with the with the European Union, but with the rest of the world. Because there is, it seems to me, a big argument to be had about this, a big argument to be had about what Brexit means and what Brexit should become. Ash Denham cited the evidence to the European Committee of my boss at the University of Glasgow, Anton Muscatelli, in which he said that we live in a world in which protectionism is on the rise. And liberal unionism, liberal internationalism, is struggling to make its voice heard. Well, my view is, and the view of my party very much is, that Brexit must not mean a surrender to nationalist protectionism. Brexit should not mean that we put up walls between ourselves and our nearest neighbours. Brexit needs to mean that we pursue what the Prime Minister has described as the freest possible trade in goods and services with the European Union, the fullest possible access to the European single market, the greatest possible participation in the European single market. Now, so there are some members of this Parliament who like to describe this as the hardest of hard Tory Brexits, but that's not what hard Brexit is. You cannot simultaneously say that what the Prime Minister is seeking is hard Brexit and then say that, you know, trade coming out of the EU and trading on WTO terms would be the hardest of hard Brexits, because these are not the same things. The Prime Minister does not want, the British government do not want Brexit to mean trading on WTO terms. What we want is the freest possible trade in goods and services with the European Union, the fullest possible access, not at the moment, the fullest possible access to the European single market and the greatest possible participation in it. And I think that we must be brave and bold in articulating that vision of free trade. The question is asked in Scottish politics at the moment, what kind of country do we want to be? Well, the kind of country I want to be is the kind of country that is one of the world's beacons for free trade, for the freedom and the liberty and the prosperity that comes with free trade. And it seems to me that that's the argument that we should be making here in Scotland. It's the argument that we should be making throughout the United Kingdom. And in terms of the answer to the question, what does Brexit mean? That is my view about what it should mean. And it's the view that Ruth Davidson and Theresa May each share. I'll give way to the Minister.
Michael Russell.
I just wonder, and I can hear the member's articulation, and I understand the articulation. Can he point to any difficulty in being that type of open, bold, and expansive nation within membership of the EU? Because it seems to work for Germany, which exports far more than we do. What is it about the EU that holds that back? Because nobody has yet defined that.
Adam Tomkins.
The answer to that is that membership of the European Union, indeed membership of the European Economic Area, prevents a member state from making a free trade agreement on its own terms with any other country in the world. It does. The European Union is a trading bloc. It has never been part of the European Union to be a proponent of free trade with the rest of the world. I want the United Kingdom to be, and my party wants the United Kingdom to be, a beacon of global free trade. Now, the second theme that I wanted to draw out in my last minute, and so therefore the last theme that I want to draw out, is this idea that what the SNP produced in December was a compromise deal, a reasonable compromise deal. Well, this is a myth that just needs to be nailed. I mean, the idea that we could have a differentiated deal for Scotland being in the European Economic Area, but the rest of the United Kingdom being outside of the European Economic Area, without there being any material change to the nature of the border between Scotland and the rest of the United Kingdom, just isn't going to work. Now, you don't have to take my word for this. You don't have to take my party's words for this. This is what Svein Roald Hansen, the head of the Norwegian Parliament's EEA and EFTA delegation, said. It's what the deputy leader of the Norwegian Parliament's Foreign Affairs Committee has said. It's what the Welsh First Minister, the minister is quite fond of quoting from Welsh ministers, but the Welsh First Minister, Carwyn Jones, has also ruled out Scotland getting a special deal from the European Union. And Professor Michael Keating of the University of Edinburgh has said, and I quote, that it's not possible. If Scotland was in the single market and the UK was outside, there would be a hard economic border between Scotland and England. Not my words, but Professor Keating's words. I'm out of time. I'm sorry.
Mr. Russell, it's finished. I know you're terribly disappointed, but it's finished. I now call Fiona Hislop up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the committee for their excellent reports and their thoughtful recommendations, and the convener, Joan McAlpine's equally excellent exposition of the content and offer. The committee offers a welcome and measured voice in the debate about Scotland's future relationship with Europe. Indeed, this is the fourth report. I spoke this morning at the opening of the Scottish Tourism Alliance conference at the launch of Scottish Tourism Week. This is a
sector of great importance to Scotland and one which has benefited from Scotland being part of the EU in the single market. And the challenges they face bring into sharp focus a number of the committee's points, in particular recognising the benefits that Scotland has enjoyed from freedom of movement and the valuable contribution our fellow EU citizens make to our economic prosperity, with over 20,000 employed in the tourism sector alone. And as Christina McAlpine pointed out, these are the same EU citizens the UK government voted not to protect in the House of Commons on Monday. Yeah. The UK ministers like to pretend they have the same approach to EU nationals as the Scottish government. They don't. We want their rights protected and guaranteed. The Tories want to use them as bargaining chips. Ross Greer pointed out how difficult it has been, and the committee report says, to complete an 85-page report to become a resident of the UK. More broadly, migration is key to addressing Scotland's demographic challenges and to our future prosperity. And as Richard Lockhead in his speech set out, the growth of our population is crucial to the growth of the Scottish economy, and EU nationals play a vital part. There are Scottish jobs and Scottish businesses that rely on EU nationals. And our ability to create a more productive and fairer Scotland depends more than ever on trading with Europe and the rest of the world and on attracting investment and talent into our economy. And as Tavish Scott said, I also would like to thank Daniel Johnson for his opening speech, or at least the first half of the opening speech, yeah, as it did set out the European proposition very well. That the greatest risk to Scottish jobs and our economy is a hard Brexit, or worse still, for the UK to leave the EU with no deal at all. Joan McAlpine cited the evidence in the report that the world has never seen dismantling of a trade arrangement in this way. Ash Denham pointed out that the evidence, from the evidence that rebuilding the trade deals we currently have will take years, let alone build anything in addition. Now, I did try and look about what I might want to quote from the Conservative benches, and I looked at Alexander Stewart, but I'd only written one word. It says bitter. Yeah. Bitter. Turning to the more substantive contributions on the committee's evidence, if we were to find ourselves in a scenario where Scotland is operating under WTO regulations outside the single market, as David Stewart set out, the Fraser Valander Institute concluded that 10 years after Brexit, Scottish GDP would be 5% lower, exports would be 11% lower, real wages 7% lower, and the number of people employed 3% lower. Richard Lockhead pointed out the agricultural issues that we faced in terms of tariffs of 30 to 40%. And Emma Harmer quoted Mr Hardwick in a second. Agricultural deals will become at the end because the most difficult deals tend to be the agricultural ones. And of course, she referenced the dairy labour market. And remember, the UK government has no mandate from any part of the UK to specifically leave the single market. Presiding officer, you can be out of the European Union, but still a member of the single market. Indeed, the Conservative government at Westminster was elected on a manifesto which I will quote, says, "We say yes to the single market." And that's just one of the reasons why the decision of the Tory government to ignore the compromise proposals of the Scottish government is democratically wrong. Now, yes, the compromise proposals are technically and legally challenging, but we have been told they are possible if the political will is there. Now, the UK is determined to drag the UK out of the single market. Yes, indeed.
Finlay Carson.
The member agree that the single market is underpinned by various policies, two of which are the common fisheries policy and the common agricultural policy. On that basis, would the minister suggest that the SNP and this government want to stay part of the common fisheries policy?
Fiona Hislop. I would say to the member, can he guarantee that the UK government will not trade the fisheries policies and position of Scotland for benefits in terms of their trading operations? Now, in terms of where we're going now, the UK government has not moved an inch towards compromise or agreement. We now clearly have a choice to follow the UK towards a hard Brexit or become an independent country. And the First Minister has set out a plan to protect Scotland's interests. We will do all we can to protect Scotland during the UK's negotiation to leave the EU. We have a responsibility to do that. When the terms of Brexit are known, we will give the choice of direction that Scotland should take before it's too late to change course. And before before people make that choice, we need to have the challenges and opportunities of independence set out. How to secure our relationship with Europe, build a stronger economy and a fairer society. I want to move on. Presiding Officer, I and my ministerial colleagues continue to be active in engaging in Europe and beyond, as Jackson Carlow has urged us to do. And I think he was a bit graceless to his convener. I might want to reflect on his remarks. Since the referendum, we have met with the EU institutions and all 27 member states. Only last week, Fergus Ewing met Commissioner Hogan and Minister Creed during a visit to Brussels. Keith Brown visited Berlin and Hamburg and across Europe and across the world. Scotland's predicament has been met with interest, understanding and open ears. Europe is listening to us. Presiding Officer, Scotland is at a crossroads. At stake is the type of country we want to be. We want to be outgoing, welcoming and a European nation. We embrace the values of democracy and let's not be driven against our will to a damaging hard Brexit. Let's give the people of Scotland the opportunity to choose their future for themselves.
I now call Lewis MacDonald to wind up the debate on behalf of the Culture, Tourism, Europe and External Relations Committee. Up to 9 minutes, please, Mr. MacDonald.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And I would like to start by adding my thanks as Deputy Convener to the committee clerks, the researchers from SPICE, the committee's advisers, and all those who have assisted us in our work, and also to thank all those who have contributed to the debate today. I would also make special mention of the elected members of the Welsh and London Assemblies who came to Scotland to discuss issues of common interest, as well as the elected representatives who met us during our visits to London and to Brussels. Today's debate has focused particularly on our most recent report, Determining Scotland's Future Relationship with the European Union. While we did not achieve complete consensus, it is striking that all five parties on the committee were able to agree to a broad range of conclusions on the basis of the evidence we heard. The report is only a fortnight old. In some respects, its conclusions and the committee's recommendations have already been overtaken by events in the way that the minister made clear at the outset of today's debate. But the tenor of those debates, of those reports, remains relevant for the period ahead. While committee members agreed about the benefits of the single market for Scotland and for the UK as a whole, we did not endorse the Scottish Government's proposed mechanism for Scotland to remain in the single market if the rest of the UK left, but neither did we reject it. What we said instead, and I quote, was that a bespoke solution that reflects Scotland's majority vote to remain in the single market should be explored with the EU27 as part of the negotiations ahead before and after the triggering of Article 50. And it's worth remembering that that phrase was agreed by us all as part of that committee. A majority of the committee believed at the time we agreed the report that a differentiated solution could be found within the EU to accommodate Scotland in the single market or in its connection with the single market. But no collective view was expressed as to what that differentiated solution might be. But we were explicit in saying that a bespoke solution for Scotland within the UK should continue to be explored after as well as before the triggering of Article 50. Whether anyone still believes that such a bespoke solution for Scotland within the UK is possible, given the events of this week, is of course a debate for another day. But suffice it to say at this juncture that nothing in the evidence we heard from Scottish ministers led us to expect a fundamental change in their approach before the triggering of Article 50. It is important to note also that the committee welcomed the intensification of discussions at official and ministerial level on the proposals made by the Scottish and Welsh governments. We called on UK ministers to respond to the Scottish government's proposals before invoking Article 50, and we asked them to say whether or not the Scottish government's objectives for differentiated solutions would be set out in the Article 50 letter to the EU. Those were reasonable demands, again commanding all party support on the committee, even if their force has been somewhat weakened by this week's wider developments. And our call for the Scottish and UK governments to work together on these matters still stands. So too does the call we made by majority for transitional agreements to be requested by the UK government in the letter triggering Article 50. The convener mentioned that in Brussels we met members of the Constitutional Affairs Committee of the European Parliament. They were clear in their discussions with us, in their view, that a withdrawal agreement would be negotiated first, and then that would be followed by a separate agreement on the UK's future trade relationship with the European Union. Our committee's report on migration and citizens' rights recognised the contribution of EU citizens living in this country, called for them to be reassured as to their future status without further delay, and acknowledged the case for a differentiated approach to the issue of free movement and migration within the UK. Now, we now know that the UK government has chosen to leave the future of EU citizens in this country to be dealt with as part of the withdrawal agreement, which will also have to deal with other difficult issues: EU staff and pensions, UK payments as part of current EU programmes, and the location of EU agencies. But even if the divorce deal dealing with all these difficult issues is done within a two-year timeframe, a future trade deal between the UK and the EU clearly will not. The Canadians, whom we also met in Brussels, took 2 years to agree the scope of what would be included in their trade deal with the European Union, and then another 5 years to agree the terms. Ratification and implementation follow thereafter. In view of such daunting timescales, the majority of the committee took the view that the UK government must seek to agree transitional arrangements as part of the Article 50 process to maintain something like existing terms of trade while a long-term agreement is put in place. And we also heard in Brussels from lawyers with an expertise in these areas that World Trade Organization rules permit transitional arrangements for up to 10 years, after which the default position of WTO terms and tariffs would come into force. Clearly, avoiding such an outcome, dependence on WTO rules, would require a final deal to be reached during a transitional period, which in turn would have to follow from the withdrawal agreement. And the committee has heard from nobody at all out with the UK government who believes that such transitional arrangements might not be necessary. On powers repatriated from Brussels, as the convener said, we concluded that any such power which is not currently reserved should be devolved alongside a funding mechanism with no detriment to Scotland. Different parties, of course, have different views on what should happen with the repatriation of other competences, but an agreed starting point for that debate is the one laid out in this report. There are many EU funding streams, but regional policy through structural funds and agricultural support are the main ones which are delivered through a territorial funding framework. The question was raised of whether there should be a UK-wide framework to support disadvantaged regions or to support less favoured areas on an objective basis agreed across Scotland, England, Northern Ireland and Wales. If that is to happen, I think it is the clear implication of this report that such a framework has to be devised by the UK government and the devolved administrations working together, rather than simply be determined by the UK government alone. Whatever the timescale for Article 50, we agreed unanimously in the committee that the respective governments should deal with European partners on the basis of an agreed approach. Current practice in relation to the Council of Ministers is described in the report in these terms. Scottish ministers have participated in negotiations following the prior agreement of a UK negotiating line and set of priorities. This principle should apply, we said, to the withdrawal agreement and any new free trade agreements. We also said that as those negotiations proceeded, a means should be found to involve the Scottish Government in discussions on future trade deals, whether that would be by creating a joint ministerial committee on international trade or in some other ways. And just as importantly, Presiding Officer, we called for the written agreement between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament to be augmented to ensure that committees of this Parliament are fully informed by ministers on both the EU withdrawal agreement and any future trade deals. Here again, events this week may have put some of those recommendations in a different light, but they remain the unanimous recommendations of all members of the committee. So these reports have not sought to lay down red lines, whether to the Scottish Government, to the UK Government, or indeed to the EU 27. What they have done is propose that if the will is there, a means can be found to square the circle of Scottish support for a close relationship with Europe and freedom of movement with the UK-wide decision to leave the EU, a decision which is not challenged or denied in these reports. They call for a response from UK governments ministers to the Scottish Government's proposals before the triggering of Article 50, they also call on both governments to continue to work together for a mutually beneficial outcome once that critical point has passed. It does not express a view on the merits or on the weaknesses of the Scottish Government's proposal. The committee divided on the merits of the UK Government's approach, but we agreed on almost everything else. So these are serious reports. They deserve to be taken seriously by all parties and by both governments. How far developments this week suggest that that is happening, I will for the moment leave for others to judge. But the only thing we can be certain of today is that we will face continuing uncertainty tomorrow. And I commend the approach taken by this committee in these reports as the right approach to that uncertainty in the period ahead.
Thank you. That concludes our debate on reports on the implications of the European Union referendum in Scotland. The next item of business is consideration of Business Motion 4609 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau, setting out a business programme. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press their request to speak button now. I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 4609.
Formally moved.
Thank you. And no member is asked to speak against the motion. The question is that we agree motion 4609. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 4610 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Bureau, setting out a timetable at stage one of the seat belts on school transport bill. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press their request to speak button now. I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 4610.
Moved.
Thank you. No member has asked to speak against the motion. The question is that we agree motion 4610. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. And the next item of business is consideration of a Parliamentary Bureau motion. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move motion 4611 on First Minister's questions, portfolio and general questions and topical questions.
Moved.
Thank you. That will be taken at decision time. And actually, before we come to decision time, members will wish to join me in welcoming to the gallery Mr. Akbar Khan, Secretary General to the Commonwealth Parliamentary Association. Thank you. There are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion 4570 in the name of Joan McAlpine on reports on the implications of the European Union referendum on Scotland be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. And the final question is that motion 4611 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on First Minister's questions, portfolio and general questions and topical questions be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. That concludes decision time. We'll now move to members' business on Commonwealth Day in the name of Stuart McMillan, and we'll just take a few moments to change seats.